National Championship with Vince Dooley at the helm. Now Jim Donnan is molding a new breed of Bulldog to challenge for SEC supremacy. Georgia's return to glory is triggered by freshman quarterback Quincy Carter. And three-way threat Champ Bailey. They hope to make the Dogs champs once again. The rise to prominence of Tennessee football began under the tutelage of General Robert Neyland and was carried on in the modern era by Johnny Majors. Current ball coach Philip Fulmer has built a record unmatched by any active coach. But this season's team has questions to answer. Can the Vols overcome the loss of Jamal Lewis? And can quarterback T. Martin lead Tennessee to another SEC title? Tennessee versus Georgia. NASDAQ College Football next on CBS Sports. The 375-member Redcoat Band marching into Sanford Stadium, marking another football Saturday at the University of Georgia. Bulldog fanatics arrived early, and the tailgaters have been out in force all day. Hug of Five, the legendary mascot, is ready for the first top 10 showdown between the Hedges in 15 years. It's the fourth-ranked Vols of Tennessee challenging number 7, Georgia. We welcome you live inside Sanford Stadium. Here come the Georgia Bulldogs. And from the far tunnel, the number 4 team of the nation, the Tennessee Volunteers. It's a meeting between Ugga and Smokey. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough, along with Terry Donahue. It's great to have you with us for another edition of NASDAQ College Football. Hard to think of a bigger matchup this weekend in college football. SEC title aspirations on the line, national championship hopes also on the line here today. When we talk about Tennessee, Coach, cruising to that 4-0 record. Jamal Lewis leading the running game, one of the best running backs in the country, but they lost him last week for the season with a knee injury.
Well, the loss of Jamal Lewis is going to be huge for Tennessee. He had 50% of their rushing yardage this season. Today, they hope to replace him with two sophomore tailbacks, Travis Stevens and Travis Henry. Travis Stevens is the faster of the two players. He's capable of making a long run. Travis Henry is more powerful. He hopes to wear down the Georgia defense. But the player, Sean, that has to come up big for Tennessee today is T. Martin, the quarterback. T. Martin has shown that he can make plays as a quarterback with his legs, but today he has to do it with his arm. I think Tennessee will take the wraps off of T. Martin. I think he'll have a good day throwing, and if he does, it'll make up for the loss of Jamal Lewis.
His opposite number is Quincy Carter, the true freshman, age 21, for the University of Georgia. Really earned national attention last week with his tremendous performance against LSU. At one point in that game, he completed 15 passes in a row.
Well, Quincy Carter is the best true freshman quarterback that I've seen play since watching John Elway at Stanford. This guy has it all: size, speed, arm strength. He has maturity beyond his years. And if he plays anywhere near like he did a week ago, Georgia can win this football game.
And his teammate Champ Bailey is starting to earn recognition as a possible Heisman Trophy candidate. He is a three-way performer.
Well, Charles Woodson won the Heisman Trophy last year. Champ Bailey is a better offensive football player than he is right now, and just as good on defense. He can make plays, cover you man-to-man. They have a little package offensively. They try to get him the ball, and when he's not doing that, he'll return kicks for these guys. He's the most versatile player in America.
And a versatile man on our team down on the sidelines. Here's Mike Mayock.
Hey, Sean, let's not forget the winner of this game takes command of the SEC East, but don't forget the bigger picture, and that is Tempe, Arizona, January 4th, the bowl championship series. Now, it's a very complicated formula. Forget all about that. The bottom line, Tennessee's number 4, Georgia's number 6. After practice on Thursday, Jimmy Donnan got his team around. He said, fellas, we win the game on Saturday, we're in a position to contend for a national title. We lose, we're out. Hey, Sean, sometimes it's a pretty simple game.
Indeed it is. Jim Donnan told a booster group before the season started, this year we are going to shock the nation. Well, if they keep winning, that might be a shock to many. They thought that this would be a rebuilding year here in Athens. They lost so many key players on their offensive a year ago. But here they are undefeated in a critical battle against Tennessee. Georgia won the toss and will receive. Jeff Hall will kick it off, and there's Champ Bailey back at the goal line. Hall kicking with a light breeze. Sent it about 7 yards deep, and Champ Bailey took a knee. So Georgia starts on offense. Last week at LSU in Baton Rouge, Quincy Carter led the Bulldogs right down the field on the opening drive. In that ball game, 27 out of 34, including, as we mentioned a moment ago, the 15 straight completions, which tied Eric Zeier's Georgia record.
Well, Jim Donnan likes to attack immediately on offense. He's a kind of wide open offensive coach that fans love to watch, because he'll really stress the Tennessee defense early in the game.
They open with three wide receivers, including Champ Bailey, who comes in motion. Orlandis Gary is the lone back behind Quincy Carter. And a screen. They tried to set it up for Bailey, and it was batted down by Sean Ellis, the left defensive end.
Incomplete. Intended for Champ Bailey.
It'll be second and 10. The skilled people around Quincy Carter, Orlandis Gary and Patrick Pass, the running backs Tony Small and Michael Greer, are the wideouts, and Larry Brown is one of the best tight ends in the nation. Matt Stinchcomb, the left tackle, will be a first-round draft pick. Chris Terry might be as well at the other tackle. Jonas Jennings is a major concern. Ordinarily a guard, he's playing center today due to the injury to Miles Lucky. He's bothered by a knee sprain and not in the starting lineup. Loose football, and it's still free, and Deion Grant has recovered for Tennessee.
Well, Sean, you said it exactly right when you said Jonas Jennings was a major concern. When you and I visited with Jim Donnan before the ball game, he said if we can get the snap from center this week, we have a great chance to win the game. But because of the injury to Miles Lucky, it is Miles Lucky playing center, who hasn't practiced all week because of a bad knee. And he's the one that short-armed the snap up to the quarterback, Quincy Carter. What a huge, huge mistake for Georgia.
Very simple, but that was the big concern for Jim Donnan, the center snap. Lucky ordinarily the center, but perhaps the knee problem forced him to change the way he snapped the ball. It was Travis Stevens on first down for Tennessee, and Adrian Hollingshead made the tackle for Georgia. And Tennessee took it over after the turnover. Great field position at the 19-yard line, led by T. Martin, the junior from Mobile, Alabama, who last week against Auburn completed just 5 passes, had just 68 yards passing. And for the season, he's completed just 44%. Travis Stevens in the eye, lined up behind Sean Bryson, and three wide receivers without a tight end for UT. Short drop. Martin throws. Intercepted by Champ Bailey.
Sean, we said before the telecast, during the telecast, Champ Bailey was one of the most versatile players in the country. He's just lined up playing man-to-man pass defense. The ball is a little bit overthrown, but he's such a gifted athlete with his hand-eye coordination. What a play by the great player.
And he had a headbutt from big and marvelous Leroy. Second interception of the year for Bailey. He is rapidly rising as one of the top candidates for the Heisman Trophy, a junior from Folkston, Georgia, who stays in on offense for the first play of this series, which begins at the Georgia 3. After the play action fake, Quincy Carter going deep, looking for Bailey, and it's just a little bit overthrown. Wayne Goodrich had the coverage. Georgia coaches think the Tennessee secondary is the weakness of that defense.
Second and 10.
And they went deep early. Sean Ellis, Jeff Coleman, Darwin Walker, and Corey Terry, the front four defensively for the Balls. Al Wilson back in the lineup after sitting out last week's game against Auburn with a dislocated shoulder. Raynock Thompson and Eric Westmoreland, the other linebackers. And there is the secondary, which will be tested today. Dwayne Goodrich, Derek Edmonds for the injured Fred White, Deion Grant and Steve Johnson. White will play today, but he's at about 80% with a bruised knee. Shotgun out of the end zone. And a whistle and a flag before the play.
John, we have some movement there by the Georgia offensive line.
I'm very surprised, based on what we saw at practice yesterday, Coach, that Miles Lucky is able to go at center. He's wearing a bulky brace He had a very difficult time yesterday at the workout. Looked like he would not play.
Dead ball foul. False start on the offense. Half the distance to the goal.
Yeah, I agree with you, Sean. When I watched Miles just try to snap and move to his right and left, I said to myself, you know, he's not a healthy athlete, and he's going to have a hard time playing, but he's so important to that line because when he can play there, Jonas Jennings can go over and play guard, which is his natural position, and that really helps Jim Donnan. You know, you talk about snaps. It seems so elementary that the center ought to be able to get the ball up to the quarterback every time without a problem, but it's a hard exchange to make.
Second down and 11 after the penalty. They set up another short pass, dangerous in the end zone, and Landis Gary could not make the catch. Well, the Bulldogs are accustomed to going the length of the field this season. The season opener against Kent, they had a 99-yard touchdown drive, which matched the longest in school history. You can't have one longer. And against South Carolina in their win in Columbia, they went 90 yards for a touchdown. That's the ninth longest drive in the proud history of Georgia football.
Well, nobody's going to accuse Jim Donnan of being conservative. He's backed up here inside his own 5-yard line. He throws deep, throws a screen pass. Guarantee he'll throw again.
High formation with Patrick Pass and Landis Gary. Neither is a true fullback. This is Pass, and he gets nothing. Ran into Billy Ratliff, the junior defensive tackle from Magnolia, Mississippi. Both teams have major problems on offense here in the first minute and a half. Much has happened in just over a minute and a half, and now Patrick Pass is limping off, favoring his right leg.
Sean, it certainly is early in the game, but so far, the Tennessee defense has its arms around the Georgia offense. It understands how they're trying to attack them, and they're very quick to the ball. One thing that a lot of people, I think, this week overlooked is that Tennessee speed on defense. They can run and get off blocks as good as anybody in the country.
Wynn Kopp is a true freshman punter and doesn't have much room to work with. He's standing right along the end line. And that's Eric Parker, another freshman, waiting to return the punt. And Tennessee should have good field position. Kopp kicking into a little breeze. And Parker standing at the Georgia 40-yard line at the moment. Doug Davis is the snapper. Pop, the left footer, got it off. Parker caught it to the 39 and retreated 3 yards back to the 42. Excellent coverage on special teams by Quentin Davis with help from Corey Robinson. A 36-yard punt, minus 3 on the return, no score in the first quarter. We're back in Athens, Georgia. No score. Just more than 2 minutes in. Here's the Tennessee starters on offense. Stevens got the start at tailback for Jamal Lewis with Bryson, the fullback. Price and Culp on the wide receivers and Diago the tight end. Change in the offensive line. Kosey Coleman moves back to guard from tackle as Josh Tucker makes his first start of the year at right tackle. They want Coleman inside working against Big Marlis Leroy. T. Martin under pressure, throws, nearly intercepted again, that time by Kirby Smart.
Sean, you know, for Tennessee on offense, it all gets down to this. They lose Jamal Lewis, a great tailback. They want to be a running team. Phil Fulmer is really comfortable being a running coach, coaching the running game. It all gets down to, can they generate enough offense with T. Martin as a thrower? He's better in the pocket than he is as a play-action passer. He's just not a real accurate player right now in terms of passing.
It's Richard Seymour who applied the pressure and put the hit on Martin just after he released on second and 10. Stevens showing that quickness to the line and showing power as well when he has a first down down to the 30-yard line. Travis Stevens, the sophomore from Clarksville, Tennessee, with a gain of 12. And here's the Georgia defense. Marlis Leroy, the best player up front in the opinion of the Tennessee coaches. Antonio Cochran, a pass rushing specialist at end. The linebackers are Hollingshed between Lucky and Grant. Grant and Hollingshed, the two leading tacklers on the team. Kirby Smart, the fifth-year senior strong safety with Larry Mann, Jeff Harris, and of course, Champ Bailey. The secondary for Georgia. First and 10 at the Georgia 30. Martin throws confidently, juggled, but caught. Cedric Wilson spins back close to a first down to the 20-yard line. And Richard Seymour has already made the acquaintance of a couple of the Volunteers. He was in the face of T. Martin a moment ago, and now he's downfield to help tackle Cedric Wilson, the sophomore from Memphis.
Well, and this is what I think we're going to see T. Martin doing more and more of, just dropping back in the pocket, not play actioning, just dropping back, running a little curl route here as Cedric Wilson makes a good reception, comes back for the ball, fights forward towards the first down.
Wilson with just his third catch of the year. He's a sophomore. Was a quarterback in high school in Memphis. Both of his previous receptions this year were in their route victory against Houston. The only one-sided win that Tennessee has had. They struggled to beat Auburn last week on the plains of Auburn, Alabama, and they had dramatic victories over Florida and Syracuse. David Martin is in at wide receiver. Seeing his first considerable action. He's been bothered by a hamstring injury. Great pursuit by Adrian Hollingshead. And down goes Travis Stevens for no gain on the play. Stevens is fast. He's a track athlete at Tennessee. In addition to his football exploits, he ran a 22.3 in the 200 meters during the 98 indoor track season. And Jamal Lewis had exactly half of all the carries for Tennessee prior to today. And he had outrushed the rest of the team by himself. He's out for the year with a knee injury. They have capable backup people, they think. Now in a spread formation, the short pass, Peerless Price, chopped down behind the line of scrimmage. Dustin Lucky, the strong side linebacker, up to drop the play back at the 24-yard line.
Tennessee tried to spread the field. They went into the shotgun formation, spread the field out, tried to get Peerless Price isolated on a little quick screen, but the Georgia pursuit, when a team is wired up like Georgia is, and they are wired for this game, those players are going to really react. I think Tennessee will start to come back with some counter plays, some misdirection plays to slow that defense down.
Third down, 14. Second possession for Tennessee. They turned it over, a great field position the first time. Martin slipped but stayed on his feet. Now he has running room to the far side of the field. T. Martin inside the 10 with a first down and pushed out by Kirby Smart inside the 7-yard line. 17 yards on the scramble. And as you said earlier, Coach, T has made many more plays with his feet this year, key plays for the balls than he has with the throwing game.
Well, there's no question about it. When he goes back to pass, the real danger in trying to defense him is as a scrambler. Here he finds room. When the pass rush collapses, he finds a little void, and off he goes to the first down. This is what Georgia's going to have to stop all day long. T. Martin as a runner.
First and goal from the 7. No score early in the first quarter. Stevens following the fullback Bryson, and Travis was stacked up at the 5-yard line.
Sean, I really am impressed with the way Tennessee has handled the game thus far. They come out, all of a sudden they have an early turnover, their defense goes in, stops Georgia immediately, they get the ball back, they're on the move again. So far, Philip Fulmer's Tennessee Volunteers have done an excellent job, I think, working the momentum of the game to their favor.
And they've been doing that all year, as you saw, having outscored their opponents 38-3 in the first quarter. Timeout called by Georgia. The Bulldogs had 10 men on the field.
Let's show our appreciation for his broadcast.
Sean McDonough, Terry Donahue, Mike Mayock back between the hedges in Athens, Georgia. Number 4, Tennessee against number 7, Georgia. And the Vols with a great chance to grab the lead. Second and goal at the 5. Georgia's red zone defense has been excellent, coordinated by Joe Kine.
I think they'll try to sprint out here with the ball.
That's what T. Martin does. Lost to the back of the end zone, incomplete. Overthrown. He was looking for Jermaine Copeland, and Jeff Harris was in coverage for the Dogs.
It's one of the things that David Cutcliffe, the offensive coordinator at Tennessee, wants to do a little bit, is to move the pocket. He doesn't want T. Martin always to be. There's David right here.
He doesn't always want T. Martin to be in the middle of that pocket so the Georgia defense can hone in on him. So that time he just moved the quarterback a little bit, tried to run a little sprint out pass. Wasn't successful, but certainly effective in affecting the Georgia defense.
David Cutcliffe, longtime assistant at UT. He's been there 17 years. Then they spread the field with four wideouts. Bryson in behind Martin. And this will stop the action. They might have taken too much time to get the playoff. Philip Fulmer could see that one coming.
Sean, what happens before the game is you take your quarterbacks out on the field.
Third down.
And you show them where the 25 second clocks are. And you say, listen, when we're down in the scoring area, you get me off the hook. You keep peeking at the 25 second clock and use a timeout or take whatever you do. Don't take a penalty in this area of the field. And that's exactly the mistake T. Martin made there.
Sometimes backing up a little bit in deep gives the passing game a little bit more room with which to work. It's a quarterback draw. Martin in trouble, and he is dropped for a loss by Antonio Cochran.
Tennessee again tries to spread the field here. They want to thin out the Georgia defense and then give the ball to an outstanding runner, which is number 17, T. Martin, the quarterback. It just didn't work. The Georgia defense swarmed to it. Probably defense to play as much on the formation as anything.
Jeff Paul will try to give Tennessee the first points of the game. A 27-yard try out of Benson Scott's hold, and as is usually the case, Hall drills it right down the middle. 3-0 Vols, nearly midway through the first. Overflow crowd here at Sanford Stadium. The folks out along Sanford Avenue looking in at this 85,000 seat facility. The ticket manager here said in his 16 years here, he can't remember greater demand for tickets. Comment made by Freddie Jones earlier this week. Champ Bailey downs the kickoff from Hall. Hall's made 16 of his last 20 field goals now. The one moment ago from 27 yards gave Tennessee the lead. Tomorrow, doubleheader NFL action here on CBS Sports. It begins at 1. Among the featured games, early Kansas City and New England. And at 4:15, Denver and Seattle at the top of the list. Great action tomorrow here on CBS. Of course, it all begins every Sunday at noon Eastern time with the NFL Today presented by Southwest Airlines. A rare breather for Champ Bailey. And substitutes in the backfield, and going nowhere is Ronnie Bradley. He ran in to Sean Ellis, the junior from Anderson, South Carolina, who is the reigning Southeastern Conference Defensive Player of the Week. You'll recall last week against Auburn, he took an interception and went 90 yards. Not exactly at record speed, but he did go the full 90 for his first career interception return for a touchdown.
He was lucky that no one from Auburn was chasing him after the first missed tackle, because he hardly made it. But that's a long interception return for a defensive lineman to hold.
Ronnie Bradley remains in for Patrick Pass, who limped off during the last possession on offense. Georgia not on track yet offensively. Carter sprints out and throws incomplete. A little bit low. He was looking for Thad Parker. And let's check in with Tim Brando, get an update on how the Spartans made out today.
Sean, for the second consecutive overtime period, Michigan State did well, thank you, on its opening play from scrimmage. This time a 25-yard Cedric Irvin touchdown run. Spartans hold on to win it in two overtime periods and even their record at 3-3.
A big win for a team that certainly has had a very interesting year to this point. Third down now, long yardage once again. Third and 15. Out of the shotgun. Carter throws, caught by the tight end Larry Brown, but he's a mile short of the first down. wrapped up by Eric Westmoreland. 11th catch of the year for Brown, a senior from Decatur, Georgia.
John, I think you said it best. Right now, the Georgia offense is not in rhythm. For whatever reasons, I think you got to credit the Tennessee defense for part of that. Tennessee has a lot of tight coverage on those Georgia receivers. There's not as much air in the defense as there was a week ago when they played LSU. And Georgia is just out of sync just a little bit. As the game wears along, you'd expect that they'd get better rhythm out of their offensive team.
Wind pop. That one looked to be off the side of his foot. It took a good bounce for Kopp and for the Dogs. Eric Parker backed away. And it rolls down to the 38-yard line. A 42-yard punt, much of it on the roll. Down to the sidelines. Once again, here's Mike.
Sean, we've talked about Champ Bailey and what it allows him to do because of his flexibility and his great man-to-man coverage. Watch this. What happens is they're taking Champ Bailey all by himself on the weak side and trying to take Peerless Price out of the game. What does it allow them to do over here? They cheat the free safety strong side. They're playing a four-man game. Strong safety corner, linebacker, and free safety over the top, playing 4-on-3. And Terry Donahue, it'll be interesting to see what adjustments are made out there.
Well, that's exactly right, Mike. That's what you can do when you have a great man-to-man cover guy playing on one guy, taking him out of the ball game. You can cheat your safety.
All new backfield, flag down. This was Travis Henry, the other part of the tandem expected to pull in at fullback, at tailback rather, in place of Jamal Lewis. He got the call running behind Will Bartholomew, the second string fullback. Arontis Grant made the tackle and a holding call against Tennessee.
Holding the initial indication against Tennessee.
And an example of the kind of coverage that Mike Mayock was talking about might have been that interception that Bailey had earlier, working one-on-one on that side with Price.
It absolutely was, Sean. That was just man-to-man coverage, putting your best athlete on their best athlete and saying, hey, let's line up and play and see what happens. That ball's overthrown a little bit, and Champ Bailey makes the play.
The penalty moves Tennessee back to the 27-yard line. Far the worst field position the Balls have had. They started at 19 in Georgia territory on their first possession, the 42 on the second. They resulted in the field goal. This time it's Arontis Grant and Brandon Miller combining to stop Travis Henry.
Well, Joe Kines, the defensive coordinator for Georgia, says that the big down linemen take up a lot of blockers. What he really wants to do is free up his linebackers. His linebackers, his three linebackers, are 1, 2, and 4 on the team in tackles. But the down linemen, when they penetrate like that, they can really disrupt an I formation running team with a tailback as deep as Tennessee's is.
Second down. Long yardage. 22 to go for a first down. A screen to the fullback, Sean Bryson. A flag thrown near where the tackle was made. We'll check the flag in a moment. Once again, here's Tim.
Sean, that Sunshine State Showdown. Chris Winkie will hook up with Peter Warrick. You know, Warrick has 6 touchdown catches on the season, all of them from Winkie. This gives Florida State the early advantage down in Miami. Florida State trying to stay in the national picture where the BCS is concerned, Sean.
Bobby Bowden told his team it really was a must-win situation with an eye toward the BCS. And an important game for these two teams.
During the run, we have an illegal block in the back on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Second down.
Well, they are seriously in reverse mode at the moment. Tennessee backed up to the 21-yard line. Looked like Peerless Price might have been the player downfield with the block in the back of Corey Robinson.
Number 37, Peerless Price, was clearly in the back. It's a good call by the official. Now, if you're Tennessee, you better be pretty careful with the ball. You've got a good defense. You're backed up, and your confidence in your throwing game is not exactly right on the money right now. So they're going to be somewhat conservative, I think.
Travis Stevens back in at tailback, and the pass is caught. Cedric Wilson with a second catch. And he's out to the 37-yard line. Kirby Smart and Jeff Harris combined to the tackle. Still well short of a first down. A gain of 16. They need to move out to the 48-yard line to pick up a first down.
Cedric Wilson's at the top of the screen. He's going to run just a little curl route. He's going to go inside and then break it inside. He just gets open in a void there. Does a good job of coming back to the ball. toward T. Martin. T. Martin delivers the ball right on target this time. Outstanding pass.
Four wide receivers on third and 11. Nearing 5 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Martin flushed from the pocket. Kirby Smart runs him down from behind, short of the first down. There's a flag down to the secondary. Kirby Smart, a very instinctive football player, in the words of Joe Kynes, and Coach Kynes also told us yesterday he's a lot faster than people think he is. He runs a sub 4.5 40, and the pro scouts are looking at him.
Well, Tennessee is under the blitz here. Georgia brought some heat, but again, T. Martin finds a little void in the pass rush, and once you do that, you can scramble. And as you said, Sean, Kirby Smart, with outstanding speed there, makes a big play.
Holding on the offense. The penalty is declined. Fourth down.
There's Joe Kynes, one of the most respected coordinators in football, and understandably so, with his track record. Tends to coach with a bend but don't break philosophy. In this era of attack style defense all over football, they still play a little bit more conservatively than some.
No question. Mostly a zone team, not as much man-to-man as a lot of teams. The thing that he does, he makes you work. Mm-hmm. When the game is over, you're exhausted from trying to pick up first downs and big plays.
Booming punt by David Leverton, his first of the day. Michael Greer, the return man, out to the 22. He took a late hit, and there's a flag. 43-yard punt, a 3-yard return, but they'll add to it with a late hit. It looked like Raynock Thompson came in. Not only late, but head first. And you can see Raynock pointing at himself. He knows he messed up on that play.
Raynock Thompson, I really don't think this is deliberate. It's going to be a late hit. It's
just, oh, boy.
It's a hard hit, and it's a big hit. But I'll tell you what, I think Raynock Thompson really regretted that once he did that.
Well, maybe he did, but I don't see how you could look at that and say it wasn't intentional. That's helmet to helmet a mile after the play.
On the kicking team, that'll be 15 yards, first down. Tennessee.
I agree with him. He pointed himself after the play, indicating his fault. But this is what happens when you tackle somebody helmet to helmet. There is always the possibility of serious injury, and Greer is down on the field.
Yeah, I think the minute it happened, he regretted the incident. There's no question, it's a flagrant violation with the helmet.
And the good news is Greer is now sitting up and has movement. Well, he might be a little bit wobbly. And he's very popular here, a native of Athens, his dad a great football player here at the University of Georgia. Steve Greer, American defensive lineman back in the late 60s, and he's now on the Georgia football staff as their director of football operations. Great to see Michael Greer back on his feet, running off under his own steam. The penalty moves the ball back out to the 37-yard line. Best field position for Georgia. The Dogs have done very little on offense. Robert Arnott belted down. Deion Grant with great safety play coming up quickly to put the hit on Arnott. A gain of two. Let's check the Sun America virtual playbook.
One of the things that Georgia is going to attempt to do today with Champ Bailey is put him into a lot of different positions. Out of the shotgun formation, Georgia's going to spread the field. They'll have Champ Bailey at the X receiver, one-on-one, inside against strong safeties or linebackers, and then they'll take the ball and try to get it to him deep down the field. This is one of the great athletes in the country, and they want to utilize him.
Deion Grant, who came up to make the tackle, is slow to get up after he collided with Arnott.
Right here, we've got the hit by Deion Grant. It's an excellent tackle by him. You can't really see. Sean, can you see what happens here?
No.
I really don't see anything that would make me think that Deion Grant, number 7, was hurt on that play.
He was a sophomore from Augusta, Georgia. Tennessee has 7 native Georgians dressed here today. Philip Fulmer's done well in recent years with his staff recruiting in this state. Jim Donnan believes that Georgia can go right back to being one of the powers, one of the top 10 programs in college football every year if they can just do the job of keeping the homegrown talent in state.
No question. I think that's Jim's number one priority, is trying to control the players that are here, keep them at the university, don't let them go out of state. There's a lot of good football players from Georgia all over the Southeastern Conference.
Mickey Allen has come in to back up Grant at the safety spot. Allen wears number 29. Second down and 8. Georgia offense, which was so impressive last weekend at LSU, has been unimpressive to this point. Carter pursued from the backside, and he is spun down back at the 31-yard line by Al Wilson.
Well, the way to contain the sprint-out quarterback is with the linebacker scraping. The middle linebacker, Al Wilson, number 27, runs about a 4.5 40, and watch him. He'll just hunt the quarterback down. As soon as he finds a lane, he'll run through it for the sack. Quincy Carter there probably needs to get rid of that ball. If the receiver isn't open, then throw it away, put it out of bounds. But again, you have a true freshman there playing quarterback.
Deion Grant kind of taking a shot in the hip or ribcage area there. Another third and long, and looked like another false start on the Georgia offense.
Chris Terry, the right tackle, number 70, jumped early.
Terry's a senior from Jacksonville, Florida. Made the transition from defensive end.
Dead ball foul, false start on the offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
He moved over to offense last year, and there's some talk that he could be a first-round draft pick. They might have bookend tackles, each of whom could be first-round picks in the next NFL draft.
Well, Chris Terry is an outstanding player on the left side. Matt Stinchcomb, number 79, is also, like you say, a bookend. He's a first-round pick for sure, and they really have two talented offensive tackles.
Carter on third down and forever, looking for forever, going deep, has a man, Tony Small, down at the 14-yard line. Flag thrown way after the play as Chris Terry got in a slap fest with one of the volunteers.
Quincy Carter throws this ball about 65 yards down the field, and really what happened, the Tennessee defensive back just kind of froze because he didn't think he could throw the ball that far. That ball came out of there like a howitzer.
And Mickey Allen, you saw, was the safety trying to get over there late. He just came in when Deion Grant was injured.
And John, there's going to be a 15-yard penalty on Chris Terry, who we were just talking about, number 7, for unsportsmanlike conduct. He took a swing at the Tennessee defensive lineman he was trying to block.
Dead ball foul, personal foul on the offense. That's 15 yards from the end of the play. It'll be a first down.
That was way after the play. It ended foolish on the part of Terry. It backs the play to the Tennessee 29-yard line. Let's check in with Mike Mayock.
Hey, Sean, as so often happens in those things, it was an exchange of head slaps between Sean Ellis and Chris Terry. The only one that was really thrown by the referee was the last one by Terry. It was at least 40 yards away from the ball where the ball was released. Just a dumb play by Chris Terry.
It was indeed. Instead of being in business at the 14, they're just inside the 30. Under 3 minutes left. Carter, pump fake, going deep, and it is broken up. Deion Grant didn't waste much time in getting back into the game. Jermaine Wiggins, their second tight end, was open, but Carter didn't quite have enough on the ball.
Since Tennessee's an outstanding defensive team is because they have a great free safety in Deion Grant. That was an excellent play by Georgia. They faked a quick screen, then they went deep down the sideline, and Deion Grant came way over from the free safety position, almost made a fabulous interception, but at the least saved that touchdown.
He did have a fabulous interception in their win against Florida in Knoxville earlier this season. Second and 10, sprint out of the gun in the face of a blitz. Carter lofts it up, looking for Champ Bailey. And the throw is out of bounds with Dwayne Goodrich in excellent coverage. They're coming after Quincy Carter, the freshman, who, when he started the season opener, was the first true freshman to start the season opening game of his collegiate career at Georgia since Johnny Rausch back in 1945. Rausch went on to start every game of his Georgia career all 45 of them, and became the first quarterback in NCAA history to start in 4 bowl games. He finished his career atop the NCAA passing charts. Roush went on to coach the Oakland Raiders in a Super Bowl. Carter, the first since Johnny in 1945 to start the first game of his career as a true freshman at quarterback for the Dogs. And this game has not been that much fun for Quincy to this point. He went nowhere. Jeff Coleman and Corey Terry made the stop.
Georgia took a play out of the Tennessee playbook. They tried to spread the field. They have a running quarterback. Although Quincy also, Carter is also a thrower, but they tried to spread the field and just run a quarterback draw, and Tennessee played it to perfection.
Carter stays in as the holder for Hap Hines. This will be a long field goal try. Hines from 48 yards out has it. Longest of the season for Hines. Each team has kicked a field goal. And Chad Holloman will handle the kickoff. Travis Stevens back deep. And the kickoff goes out of bounds. They've been alternating Hines and Holloman as the kickoff men. Holloman has a stronger leg, but he's prone to kicking it out of bounds. And that's what happened that time.
In this game, certainly, Sean, you'd think that Tennessee has an advantage in the kicking game. Georgia has not punted the ball well. They don't kick the ball off well, although that was really a wonderful kick they just made on the field goal. But all in all, Georgia does not have as strong a kicking game as Tennessee.
The ball comes out to the 35-yard line. Travis Henry opens this possession. That tailback behind Sean Bryson. And Henry's ahead to the 38-yard line, a gain of 3. Richard Seymour made the stop. If you have not seen the new detective show Buddy Farrell, Friday's episode is the one not to miss, with special appearances by our own Greg Gumbel, Phil Sims, and Marcus Allen. Well, we understand none of them is going to win an Emmy, but they had a lot of fun on Buddy Farrell, and you will too, Friday night at 9, right here on CBS.
What about you and I, Sean? When do we get to go on this show?
I don't know. Maybe Sammo Hung will invite us on his program.
Why not?
Phillip Crosby now in at fullback in front of Travis Henry. Henry with a burst of speed. He's the stronger of the two tailbacks filling in for Lewis at 5'11", 212. David Cutcliffe, who, as we mentioned earlier, has been an assistant in Tennessee for 17 years, says Henry has the best lower body among running backs that they've had in his entire time at UT.
Well, I like the way Travis Henry just hit that last play. He hit it going downhill 100 miles an hour. He attacked it. If he'll keep that up, he'll start to affect the Georgia defense.
Third down and 2. As the clock ticks down to 30 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Martin downfield, overthrown, looking for Cedric Wilson. Good drop by the linebacker Will Witherspoon, might have forced a high throw. He was sitting down the zone in the flat, and Martin had to throw it over his head. That made the throw too high for Wilson.
Well, as we mentioned earlier, Joe Kines, the defensive coordinator of Georgia, is not going to make it easy on you. He's going to drop a lot of guys into coverage and make it hard to find lanes to hit passes in.
David Leverton punted away to Champ Bailey. As Greer took a late hit after he returned the last punt. We haven't seen him since. Bailey pushed out of bounds at the 24-yard line with 9 seconds left in the quarter. Derek Edmonds shoved him out, a 46-yard punt, a 13-yard return by Champ. He's from Folkston, Georgia. They call it the gateway to the Okefenokee Swamp. It's 6 miles from the Florida border, town of about 2,200, 3 traffic lights. The great high school football down in that part of Georgia. Charlton County High School. Champ was a star there, as was his brother Ronald, who graduated last year. Went to camp with the Dallas Cowboys. And they have Boss Bailey, the third member of the family, to play here. There's a backup linebacker in his true freshman season. Orlandis Gary had the pass, still out of action with a sprained ankle. Gary out to the 29, a gain of five on the final play of the first quarter. The score, Tennessee 3 and Georgia 3. We'll return to Sanford Stadium after these messages and a word from your local station. Start of the second quarter. Georgia with the football in a 3-3 game. Looking at second down and five. Dogs at their own 29-yard line. Lindsey Carter, inside handoff. Ronnie Bradley lost the football late. The Tennessee players indicating it's their ball, but was he down before the ball came out? There's also a flag down on the play. None of the officials have indicated that it is Tennessee's ball. Looked like Bradley's forward progress had been stopped.
Holding the initial indication against
holding the call against Donnan's Dogs.
Play was started just shy of the 29.
And here's Bradley. When does the ball come out? It's ripped out.
It's a strip. Mm-hmm. They missed the call. That ball is stripped loose. It looked like
holding on the offense has 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
Looked like Eric Westmoreland, the outside linebacker, stripped that ball out of there.
The only question might have been whether the forward progress had been stopped, but it did not appear to be. Bradley looked to be trying to lunge ahead for another yard just as Westmoreland pulled it out. A holding call moves Georgia back to its own 18-yard line.
Right now, you got to be impressed with the way the Tennessee defense is handling the Georgia offense. Other than the long pass that Quincy Carter hit, Tennessee's been absolutely in control of this offense to this point in time.
Carter with the back staying in pass protection, throws too long, looking for Tony Small. Delighted to have you with us on an absolutely perfect football Saturday in Athens, Georgia. Sean McDonough along with Terry Donahue and Coach, two of the best teams in the country, but a little bit of a sloppy start to this one.
Well, no question. Each team's had a turnover already, but I think that both of the teams will get their rhythm as the game evolves. I think when you're so fired up like these guys are, they both know the importance of this game in the national championship picture, and they're going to get their rhythm as the game just keeps going along. And I expect that both offenses will begin to move better than they are right now.
Another third and long. Georgia's been facing that throughout this football game to this point. Movement across the line of scrimmage by Sean Ellis. Larry Brown short of a first down. There is a flag down. We'll check out the flag after this from Tim Brando.
Sean, you know Larry Brown's an impact player, but so too does Miami have an outstanding tight end. And Daniel Frank, 6'6", 245-pound sophomore, utilized here to tie the game at 7 in the Sunshine State.
Very quietly, Coach Scott Covington, the quarterback for Miami, has played effectively.
He really has. He ranks well in national efficiency.
All sides on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
And as you say, Sean, that's a good description. Very quietly. He hasn't had a lot of fanfare around him, but Miami's getting better. They're starting to recover from the sanctions that they suffered, and their team is probably a year or two away from being back to national prominence, but they're a better football team this year than they were a year ago.
The pass play to Brown got more than the 5-yard penalty, but they elected to take the penalty because the pass play brought them short of the first down, would have created fourth down. The penalty gives them another chance. We talked about the sloppy nature of this game. The two teams have received a combined 9 penalties. Look out. Carter almost could not finish his drop, and now he is dropped at the 23-yard line. Sean Ellis knocked him down. Darwin Walker had the quick early pressure. And the Georgia offense continues to be very ineffective.
Well, coming into this game, the Tennessee defense had 15 sacks and 25 tackles for losses. And the reason they have those kind of numbers is they constantly bring pressure and heat on the quarterback. And when you're playing against a true freshman quarterback like Quincy Carter, if you're defensive coordinator John Chavis, you're saying, hey, guys, I'm bringing the heat on that guy. I'm going to see if he can play as a veteran.
Wincoff's punt fielded by Eric Parker. He avoided one tackler. And he lunges ahead to the 48-yard line. Quentin Davis was quickly downfield for Georgia, but couldn't bring him down. A 34-yard punt by Kopp, a 5-yard return by Eric Parker. We ask the question, who is the best player in college football? Each week, CBS Sportsline breaks down the top players position by position. And you can cast your vote on the Player of the Week poll. Go to keyword CBS Sportsline on America Online.
It's going to be interesting to watch that race unfold. A lot of football ahead of us now. A lot of good weeks. A lot of big games.
T. Martin, 4 out of 8. For 28 yards passing and 1 interception. Tied at 3 early in the second quarter. Martin in trouble. Lost the ball! Brandon Miller knocked it out. And it looks like it will be Tennessee's ball. Back at the 31-yard line.
Well, Georgia came with just a 4-man rush. It was really a coverage sack. Georgia had excellent coverage in the secondary. The offensive line protects long enough. This ball needs to be released. Eventually, it's stripped. T. Martin has got to put that ball away. Look at the second effort by the Tennessee offensive lineman.
Wow, it looked like Dustin Lucky had that ball for Georgia, and then Spencer Riley ripped it away from him. There's Lucky, seemingly with the ball in his control, and then Riley jumped in and ripped it away from him. Big play by Spencer Riley, the center. Sean Bryson knocked down at the 36-yard line by Antonio Cochran and Josh Millard.
You know, you got to give Spencer Riley some credit here. When this ball is loose, he just goes after it and just rips it out, like you say, Sean. And generally, offensive linemen, you know, they're not used to seeing that thing like that.
Well, if you're Dustin Lucky and somebody 295 pounds comes crashing down on top of you, that might cause you to cough it up. Cochran made the tackle the last play. Seems like this game has been filled with 3rd and 22s. That's the situation for the Vols at their own 36. Good fake by Martin. He throws an interception. Picked off by Tim Wansley, a true freshman from Buford, Georgia. His first career interception.
What happens to you, Sean? There's a penalty here. What happens to you when you get in long yardage situations? You feel the pressure to throw the ball. And T. Martin is just getting his feet wet as a quarterback. He's going to get better and better.
Dead ball foul. Sportsmanlike conduct on Georgia. 50 yards.
Excessive celebration. The call after the interception by Wansley.
John, I just want to finish this point. All quarterbacks, no matter how experienced they are, they throw into coverage. T. Martin just threw into coverage, plain and simple.
A lot of it. And Wansley picked it off. Second interception thrown by Martin. But a couple of big plays by Georgia today have been diminished by penalties that have followed. They have a long pass play that got them to the 14-yard line, but then they had a personal foul that moved it back near the 30. And this interception has been pushed back 15 yards by the celebration penalty. Coach David Cutcliffe told T. Martin earlier this week, this is the week the apprenticeship ends. They've taken it easy on T. Martin, leaned heavily on the running game the first 4 games of the season. Now they're going to need to throw it more without Jamal Lewis. And to this point, been mixed results for T. Martin, but the 2 interceptions jump out. Carter throws quickly to Tony Small in traffic, a short game. On the 35 out to the 39. Dwayne Goodrich made the tackle. One of the big stories of the early season, the Arkansas Razorbacks. Here's Tim.
Sean, it's all about unselfishness. I know Coach Donahue likes that. Madre Hill tore his ACL a couple of years ago. He returns, and there's a young back named Chris Chikuma in the way. They're sharing time now, thank you. Madre gets the first touchdown of the day against Memphis in a non-conference affair. Arkansas by a touchdown.
And as we come back to Athens, whistles before the next play. With Georgia looking at 2nd down and 5. Timeout called by Tennessee. CBS Sports coverage of NASDAQ College Football will continue after this word from your local station. In the tremendous buildup leading up to this game this week, the major story was the alleged feud between the two head coaches dating back to last year's game, when Jim Donnan thought that Tennessee ran it up on him, scoring a late touchdown with Peyton still in the game, on their way to a 38-13 win over the Dogs in Knoxville. Second down and six. Carter, the backside blitz, throws on the run, caught. First down in the Tennessee territory, Tony Small. On the receiving end of the 46, a gain of 16. Both coaches downplayed the alleged feud in the week leading up to this game, although you got the sense talking to them that there wasn't a lot of love on either side. Matter of fact, Philip Fulmer, when Mike Mayock tried to ask him about it, said he wasn't going to do any interview if that question was involved. But the game this afternoon, everybody anxious to see if they'd visit on the field during the stretching, and they actually talked for quite a long time after a handshake.
Sean, you know, coaches go through that. You know, you get emotional. Football is such an emotional thing, and you get upset after a game, but you forget it fast.
Quick pitch to Robert Arnaud. And Arnaud goes down at the line of scrimmage, upended by Raynock Thompson.
Ran a little option play out of the shotgun, which is kind of an unusual play for Georgia. They put it in just this week. It was not executed the way Jim Donnan had hoped it would be. He pitched way too quickly. Quincy Carter pitched on the end way too fast, and consequently, Tennessee was able to swarm to the ball. But one thing about Donnan, he really makes you work. He formations you. He gets the ball to a lot of different players. He's not afraid. He doesn't play offense afraid. He plays very aggressive offense, and he makes you work, but you got to hand it to Tennessee right now. Their defense is doing an excellent job.
Sam Bailey at wide out, bottom of your screen, on second and 10. Flag down, two flags down, Small down after the reception for the first down of the 35 of the play stand. Derek Edmonds made the stop, a gain of 11.
Sean, I think we're going to have defensive holding against Tennessee. They were trying to work over Champ Bailey. It looked to me like he was held on the play.
Yeah, it must have been very obvious, the face mask, because two officials threw the flag in the exact same spot, right in front of the Georgia sideline.
5 yard face mask on the defense, 5 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Well, there's a face mask by the Georgia offensive lineman against the Tennessee defensive lineman. That should have been called as well. They missed that one and called the other one. So things even out generally in the game.
Smokey didn't like the call. First and 10. Small with four catches now for 89 yards. And you sense that Georgia might be starting to find a rhythm on offense. They'll play the rest of the game without Michael Greer, who suffered a back injury when he took that late hit while returning the punt. Carter scrambling, needs to get rid of it, did not. He's down at the 36-yard line, knocked down by Al Wilson.
Quincy Carter was trying to get the ball down to Champ Bailey. Champ Bailey, number four, he's the guy that has a little package of plays. He's just trying to work. Tennessee's got pretty good coverage, and he wants it deep. But Quincy just couldn't get rid of it. It was good pressure by the Tennessee front, and they sacked him.
Champ Bailey, well covered. Al Wilson of the sack, the second for Tennessee. Interesting, we chatted with Al Wilson earlier in the week. Asked him about the shoulder that kept him out of last week's game. He said, are you healthy? He said, I'm healthy enough.
I know, wasn't that a great quote?
Mm-hmm.
I said to myself, boy, you want that guy playing middle linebacker for you.
Carter throws quickly. Caught by Thad Parker. Good move in traffic. He's pulled down well shy of a first down at the 28-yard line. Eric Westmoreland made the tackle. Al Wilson also said if he was grading himself for this season today, he'd give himself a C-.
Yeah, I think Al was way too hard on himself. He's playing certainly at a B-plus level. Think about the Florida game where he caused three fumbles, and this guy's all over the field. He's got great speed. It's one thing about Al Wilson, he can run so fast that he can track you down, whether you're a quarterback or running back, and here he just closes in for the kill and knocks him down.
Al said he gave himself such a low grade because he isn't making enough plays. He made the play one play ago. Now third down and eight. Blitz again. Carter throws, caught. Olandis Gary short of the first down at the 22-yard line.
What? Sean, you talk about an unbelievable play by Quincy Carter. He was under duress. And he's, you know, he's so big and strong. You're talking about a guy that's 6'3", 225 pounds. And I thought for sure he was going to get sacked here. And he just somehow found a guy. Look at the heat this guy's under. And he's strong enough to get rid of the ball. Boy, that's impressive. And it's a little touch pass underneath.
Pat Hines will try a 40-yarder. That one is no good. Wide right. He was playing the hook. And the ball would not turn to the left. So Hines is 1 for 2 on field goal tries today. And the Balls and Dogs are still tied at 3. Thank you, Tim, here in Athens. 7 minutes left till halftime. 3-3 the score. Tennessee begins at its own 23-yard line. The pitch to Travis Stevens. Trying to turn the corner. Len Ford is giving Champ Bailey a breather at cornerback up to force the play with help from Kirby Smart. Here's Mike Mayock.
Sean, Al Wilson took a direct shot on that right shoulder that he had injured and dislocated 2 weeks ago. Now it's a direct shot. He did not further dislocate it. He's not wearing a harness. He's got a homemade tape contraption underneath that shoulder pad. So they think he's going to go back in. No further dislocation, but Sean, he's going to have to play in a lot of pain.
Travis Stevens. Still the tailback behind Sean Bryson. Good fake by Martin. Has running room, picks up a block, and goes out of bounds near a first down at the 32. Kirby Smart again chased him out.
Little bootleg by Tennessee again to take advantage of that fast pursuit by the Georgia defense. T. Martin came out clean as a whistle. Just came around the left side of the offensive line and couldn't find a receiver, but picked up a excellent game with his legs, and that's what he's got to continue to do, and then mix in a few completions and try to move the ball.
Third and one upcoming. Stevens and Bryce in the backfield. They didn't go to Henry, the power back, in this short yardage situation. They go to Stevens, and he finds a big hole and a first down. Quentin Davis made the tackle that might have saved a huge gain or even a touchdown, but it's a pickup of 11 and a first down for the Volunteers.
Chad Clifton, the left tackle for Tennessee, made a great block on the backside. You can watch him here. Watch that guy right there. He's the guy that opens a hole. He turns his man outside. All of a sudden, the back can cut back into that void. It's excellent offensive line play and good vision by the tailback.
Tennessee with 54 yards rushing now. Phillip Crosby in at fullback, lined up in front of Stevens. Martin, his pass deflected, and it falls incomplete. Boss Bailey, the youngest of the three Bailey brothers who played at the University of Georgia, true freshman, batted it down. It's kind of frightening when Champ told us yesterday that Boss is the best athlete in the family.
I know, when he said he runs 4-4 at 215 pounds, and he says, I hate to say it, but little brother's more athletic than I am. I about fainted on the practice field.
Champ runs a 4-3-40. Joe Kynes, the defensive coordinator, says they can't measure his vertical leap because he jumps over the pole that they use. Martin. On 2nd and 10. Hands it off straight ahead, and Adrian Hollingshed made the tackle on Travis Stevens.
Sean, the Tennessee coaches are going to see that cutback lane that they just saw a couple plays ago. It was there again. And because you have a young back, David Cutcliffe, he's going to see that from the press box, and he'll get the word down to those tailbacks. Hey, guys, there's a backside lane for you. Just don't hit it so quickly. Just be a little more patient, and you'll be able to get backside. David right there.
Third down. A long 8 to go for a first down. 4 wide receivers. Stevens, the lone back. Martin with a 4-man rush that was well picked up. Cedric Wilson, another catch. He broke a tackle. And he is collared at the 22-yard line of Georgia.
Well, T. Martin doesn't hit many passes a lot of times, but when he does, they're big ones. Cedric Wilson is going to run an inside route. The inside curl routes are open in the middle against the Georgia defense. And of course, where has Cedric Wilson been up until this game? All of a sudden, he's emerged today as one of the potential stars for Tennessee. A huge reception.
And two catches all year. He has three today for 60 yards. That one covered 34 yards. Corey Robinson made the tackle. Now Stevens gets very little. Perhaps nothing. Stacked up by Arontis Grant and Brandon Miller in the middle of that Georgia defense.
Tennessee has liked the inside breaking routes against the Georgia defense thus far today. There's some air in that zone defense, and T. Martin is good at throwing that pass, too. He seems comfortable and confident with that particular throw.
Jim Donnan's in his third season here at Georgia. That was offensive line coach Chris Selfo, also the assistant head coach, standing next to him. Travis Stevens, Sean Bryson in the eye. 31 yards rushing for Stevens. Martin showing his elusiveness, and then he is sacked by Cochran. A loss back to the 23-yard line. Another third and long for Philip Fulmer.
Awesome. 10 yards on the play.
Only both offenses have been dogs here in the first half.
Well, they're struggling about it, but again, I think you got to credit the defense. You know, I'm one of those guys, if the offense isn't going well, it's because somebody on the other side of the ball is doing something to it.
And you're absolutely right.
And the Georgia defense and the Tennessee defense are playing well, and the offenses are out of sync right now, but they're working at it.
Martin, under pressure, steps up. Throws into traffic and incomplete, nearly intercepted by Bailey and Smart. Champ Bailey nearest to it. Kirby Smart was right there, and Martin is fortunate that that was not INT number three.
He really, as he threw again into coverage, Champ Bailey locking on man-to-man on Peerless Price. Two really outstanding big-time players working against each other. Price is looking. All of a sudden, he was looking for anything coming across, and Georgia had excellent coverage both ways on him.
Jeff Hall trying to put Tennessee back on top. He connected from 27 earlier. This is a 40-yard try right in the middle of the field. Hall's a candidate for the Lou Groves Award as the nation's best place kicker, and he's done nothing to disappoint his fans, and we've seen him. 6-3 Tennessee on the strength of two field goals by Jeff Hall coming up at halftime. The Accident Equitable halftime report. Tim, Craig, and Lou ready to bring you up to date with all of today's scores and highlights. Jeff Hall kicks off now with 302 career points after that field goal. The kickoff muffed by Arnaud, and what a big break for Tennessee as Arnaud muffed the kickoff and it rolled out of bounds inside the 10-yard line.
Robert Arnaud has a great chance to catch this ball. It drove him back a little bit. It just went really right between his arms. It's one of those things, you work on kickoff return, you get your punt returners, everybody in the kicking game handling balls, and you get into a big game and sometimes you just make a mistake.
We'll see how Jim Donnan decides to play it. He is not a conservative coach, and that is certainly an understatement. He generally plays it wide open, as he did earlier in the game when he was backed up inside his own 10-yard line.
I know Jim certainly didn't expect to have 3 points at this point in the game. I believe that he thought he could move the ball on Tennessee's defense.
Here's Olandis Gary. Out to the 34-yard line. Chris Ramsour is in for Al Wilson at linebacker. made the stop on Gary, so they are quickly out of the hole created by the muff kickoff. A pickup of 26 for Gary, the senior from Washington, D.C.
Well, Georgia went into two tight ends, and consequently, the cutback lanes are what happens. The ball is handed deep to the tailback. He starts one side, but he sees with his vision the cutback lanes. And the hardest thing when you're playing defense is to make sure all those backside lanes are sealed. Every gap is taken. That time, Tennessee didn't have every gap accounted for.
Gary transferred in 2 years ago from Marshall. He played for Jim Donnan at Marshall University and came with him when Donnan took the head coaching job here. Gary again. And Al Wilson is on the field for Tennessee and made the tackle. Gary and Jermaine Wiggins wanted to transfer along with Jim Donnan. Jim Donnan said they were very important, particularly in his first year, when Gary and Wiggins had to sit out his red shirts. But those two convinced the rest of the players. Say, this guy's not a Division I AA coach. He's a big-time coach. He knows what he's doing. He cares about his players. You'll like playing for him if you just give him a chance.
Yeah, Jim told us yesterday that it was very instrumental in him being accepted by the Georgia players, because he didn't recruit the Georgia players. So they didn't know what to think about Jim Donnan.
Chargers throw low, looking for Champ Bailey. It's incomplete. And that'll bring up third down and 8.
You know, Sean, going back to the Marshall plan that we were just talking about, when you have guys in the locker room, that affects your team. Mm-hmm. Whether they be good guys or bad guys, it's so critical to have the right chemistry in the locker room. And when you have two guys like that who went and were with you when you played for national championships and things like that, they're in there preaching and talking about how positive everything is, and consequently they can just bring guys along with them. And that's what happened for Jim and Georgia.
Third and 8 with 1:51 left in the half. Tennessee leading by 3. The Dogs from their own 36. Carter wrapped up and managed to throw it away. They're looking for a grounding call and they get it. Darwin Walker took Carter down to the ground. And the flag was thrown by the referee Steve Shaw for intentional grounding.
Well, John Chavis, the defensive coordinator at Tennessee, has not been afraid to bring the heat. Raynock Thompson comes from the top of the screen. There's an awful lot of pressure on Quincy Carter, but I really don't think this was a very good call, Sean. I saw a receiver over on the sideline. And I thought that, yeah, he's throwing the ball away, but there was a receiver in the area that he threw the ball. There's no question he's dumping the ball off. Darwin Walker with excellent pressure inside. There's John Chavis, the defensive coordinator right there. John loves to bring the pressure. He's a pressure coach.
Wynn Kopp will punt. Tennessee should get it back. A good field position, a chance to put more on the board before halftime. Kopp has been the master of the bounce. Short punts that have taken favorable roles for the true freshman today. A 39-yard punt when it stopped rolling. Corey Robinson downed it for Georgia at the 34. Time for today's Aflac trivia question. And we want to know, who was the Georgia coach the last time the Dogs beat Tennessee? We mentioned earlier in the telecast, Tennessee has won 7 straight in this rivalry. Georgia has never lost 8 in a row to any conference opponent.
Wow, there's a lot on the line for both teams. You're preaching that in the locker room before you take the field. Both coaches are talking about, let's make it 8 in a row. The other one's saying, hey, we don't want to be the first team to let that happen to us.
On the delay, it's Travis Stevens out to the 41-yard line. And he struggles close to a first down. He's supposed to be the smaller, shiftier back, but he's shown some power here today as well.
Boy, that was a good, tough run by Travis Stevens. He kept fighting for every yard he got. You can be assured those tailbacks at Tennessee, they're sorry what happened to Jamal Lewis, but they're excited about their opportunity.
2 timeouts left for Tennessee. Bryson, the receiver, has the first down and 2nd and short. He went out of the 46-yard line, pushed out by Champ Bailey. 58 seconds left in the half and 2 timeouts for Philip Fulmer. Tennessee in possession of a 6-3 lead.
Tennessee is in position here with a couple first downs to get that field goal team back on, or to possibly get a touchdown. I think they're going to try to strike here and possibly knock Georgia out.
Martin fell down as he backed away from center, back of the 41.
Down at the 41.
And what happens on that particular play, Spencer Riley, the center, or Cozy Coleman, the right guard, when they step back, they tend to catch the quarterback's foot, and that's what happened. He just got tripped coming away from the center.
Timeout, Tennessee. Sean McDonough, Terry Donahue, Mike Mayock, back in Athens, Georgia, 77 degree afternoon. We talked earlier about Joe Kynes, the defensive coordinator, perhaps doesn't pressure and blitz as much as some, but today they've come after T. Martin with regularity.
Yeah, he's brought a little more pressure than I expected. He likes to build a wall on defense and try to get people running east and west, not north and south. And he wants to make the quarterback try to beat you. But Tennessee has found some voids in that pass defense today and hit some passes. And Georgia's generated some sack yardage, too.
Second and 14. Just the three-man rush that time. And that's typical Georgia football there. Bryson tackled quickly by Tim Wansley, but there is a flag thrown where the tackle was made. And perhaps for a face mask.
And Sean, that's typical Joe Kynes. You just mentioned, you know, he drops eight guys there. He's saying, hey, I want them all back deep. I'm not going to give you anything easy.
Five-yard face mask on the defense. 5 yards from the end of the robot. Repeat, second down.
Here's the scoring summary. First points of the game of the first quarter on a 27-yard field goal by Jeff Hall. Hap Hines connected from 48, longest of the season for him, to tie it at 3. And then moments ago, Hall from 39 officially put Tennessee back on top. Second and 6. Martin throws, man open, first down into Georgia territory. Peerless Price tackled by Kirby Smart. A gain of 16, 24 seconds left, and one timeout remaining for Tennessee. Clock stops in college football to allow the movement of the chains. Now it runs. And Martin spikes it into the ground.
You know, yeah, Tennessee is probably 5 yards out of really secure field goal range here. And they have found some inside holes in that defense. I've said that two or three times, and it's evident. And those inside routes are affecting Georgia. Georgia's going to have to change the drops of the backers a little bit and tighten down that coverage a little bit, because T. Martin, he likes that pass. You can tell watching right from up here. When he's throwing that pass, he's comfortable with it.
On second and 10, Martin throws, caught by Price. But that was inbounds and short of a first down, so they have to use the timeout.
Timeout, Tennessee.
13 seconds remaining in the first half in Athens. Jeff Hall on the sideline, but Terry, it's risky for Tennessee if they run another play without a timeout. Something bad happens and they can't stop the clock. They can't get Hall in to try a field goal, and they are in his range now.
No question. I think Tennessee will probably let Jeff Hall. The question is, do you want a few more yards? But if you don't get the ball out of bounds, you're not going to get the kickoff. It's just that simple.
Well, he's such a good kicker. The extra yards you wouldn't think would make that much of a difference. He has more than enough leg to make it from here.
I think they'll kick this ball.
And here comes Hall. The only thing that would make sense otherwise would be to throw it in the end zone, because
why
try to get more yards for a field goal when he can make it with ease from here? He's made 17 of his last 21, including 2 for 2 today. This is a 43-yard attempt. It would be his longest of the day from the right hash mark. And Terry, not only does he make just about all of them, but they are perfectly dead center. They remind me of your tee shots when you occasionally play golf.
But I'll tell you what, give Philip Fulmer and Coach David Cutcliffe credit for that drive. That was an impressive short time on the clock drive to get some points and some momentum going into that halftime.
Three field goals by Jeff Hall, a senior from Winchester, Tennessee. A team captain. Now the third all-time scorer in University of Tennessee history, behind only John Bexford and Fuad Rivez. We mentioned the national implications of this game. We've also talked about the SEC picture, and obviously the team that wins this game has the upper hand in the SEC East. It will be the only remaining undefeated team in the division. Florida would like to see some help from Georgia today, because the Gators will still have a shot at Jim Donnan's team, trying to avenge the loss that the Gators suffered against the Bulldogs in Jacksonville last year.
No question who Florida's rooting for. You're right, Sean. And you know, if Tennessee wins this game, then having beaten Florida, having beaten Georgia, they have a pretty good path to that national championship game. And they're playing this game very well. And T. Martin had some important completions on that last series.
Hall bounces it down the field, and it's down by one of the up men. That was Earl Chambers, the backup strong safety, on his knees at the 28-yard line.
Sean, two things that have happened to Georgia's offense today that I've noticed. One is that the coverage that Tennessee has clamped on them, on their wide receivers, are playing a lot of tight man-to-man, and they can't quite get open. They don't have the air that they had a week ago against LSU. And the other thing is, they have brought the heat on the quarterback, Quincy Carter. Knowing he's a true freshman, they said, hey, baby, we're going to go after him regardless and see how he plays. And he's handled it well, but they've sacked him a lot and had a lot of long yardage situations for Georgia.
Carter's been pressured many times, sacked twice. He's 7 of 16 for 108 yards. And he's going to air it out. Look at that throw. It winds up being intercepted by Derek Edmonds. But Carter threw that ball about 60 yards in the air. That's the end of the first half. And the interception by Edmonds is first of the season. He's a junior from Tampa. Here is Mike Mayock.
Hey, coach, your defense has stood up pretty well. Are you surprised at your offense?
Some field position. You know, they're just working their center over, working us inside, and we got to get us a plan to run the ball and get some field position. Our defense has played good, and their defense is playing great. We just a little disheveled right now. We'll make some changes, though.
You know, coach, in that last drive, you were at minus 13 yards, negative yardage till that last drive. You got to run the ball, don't you?
Well, we got to do something. Maybe that's a good idea.
Thanks, coach.
Don't you love that guy?
I really do like Jim Donnan, because no matter what you ask him, you're going to get an answer. Halftime, Tennessee 9, Georgia 3. Stay tuned. Tim, Craig, and Lou bring you up to date on all the scores and highlights on the College Football Today AXA and Equitable Halftime Report. Georgia down by 6 at halftime, and the Bulldogs will kick off to begin the second half. Chad Holloman will kick it away. Back deep, standing at his own 2-yard line, is Travis Stevens. Holloman, another one toward the sidelines, and another that goes out of bounds. He's done that twice today, and that's going to drive Jim Donnan crazy. And Coach Donahue, think to many the score is a surprise. Last week, Georgia went to LSU. Those two teams went up and down the field. Today, a much different game.
Well, no question. Both of the defenses have got a good beat on those offensive teams right now. Both offensive teams have turned the ball over. And I expect that Jim Donnan and Phil Fulmer will go in at halftime, make some adjustments, and try to get the ball moving better.
You heard Jim Donnan say that he needed to find a way to get his team going with the running game. Jim said, coming into the game, well, they hadn't had much from the running backs in the running game all year. That's been the case again today. Travis Henry gets nothing. On first and 10 from the 35, Richard Seymour led the defensive surge. Now the core is light. Halftime statistics, just 12 first downs combined. They combined for 76 rushing yards, and each team turned it over twice.
And again, Sean, you know, you ask yourself as a coach, hey, are we playing that poorly on offense, or are the defenses just playing that well? I'm not sure we know the answer.
Loss of one. T. Martin in the first half was 9 of 17. With two interceptions, he threw for 92 yards with a long completion of 34. He sets up a screen to the fullback, Sean Bryson. And he's pulled out of bounds by Kirby Smart.
Pass complete to Bryson out of the backfield. There's a flag on the play.
Flag down in the backfield. Roughing the quarterback will be the call. T. Martin took a late hit. Neither quarterback posted big numbers in the first half.
Boy, if you're a Georgia fan, you're going to be upset.
On the defense, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
You're going to be upset with this particular play by Georgia. There's a late hit on T. Martin, clearly, and plus he uses a helmet. Whenever you do that, you can just be assured the flag's going to come out.
Antonio Cochran flagged on the play. That moves the balls into Georgia territory at the 46-yard line.
And Georgia had played two good plays on defense there and looked like they were going to force Tennessee into a clear throwing situation.
Travis Henry is the tailback, and as Martin backed out from underneath center to change the play, there was movement right over the ball from the Georgia defense. It was a Marlis Leroy who appeared to make contact.
Dead ball foul, contact by the defense, 5 yards, still first down.
They run in three nose guards to the Dogs. Leroy's the starter. He's the heaviest of the group. He helped form that wall that you were talking about that Joe Kynes mentioned. He can tie up a number of blockers. Then they bring in Millard, and he's quicker. And Brandon Miller's in between. On first and five, there's Henry squirting through. Arontis Grant leg tackled him at the 33-yard line. That's another first down for the Volunteers.
Well, Sean, not only do they play three nose guards, they play 12 defensive linemen at Georgia. They want to make sure they're strong in the fourth quarter. So Joe Kynes says, hey, we're going to play 12 defensive linemen so we can get up there, stop the running game, be able to pressure the quarterback, particularly late in the game. And when you get a big man tired, he usually can't recover. So you got to make sure you don't get those big guys too tired, because you'll lose them for the ball game.
First and 10 at the Georgia 33. Martin, all kinds of running room. Inside the 10. And down inside the 4-yard line. Kirby Smart and Larry Mann made the tackle after a gain of 30.
T. Martin once again goes back on a play action type pass. He just sees a hole in the rush lane. It's going to come right over there. He sees it. He just grabs it and takes off with that great running ability of his. He puts the ball away. It's an excellent scramble. This guy has been able to make plays. He doesn't make them all the time, but he can make some big plays that hurt you.
First and goal. Tennessee looking for the first touchdown by either team today. Henry stacked up by Kirby Smart and Arontis Grant. They'll mark him down to the 3-yard line. Second and goal from there. T. Martin continues to make big plays in the running game, as he has throughout the season. He thinks his lack of effectiveness in the passing game, Terry, has been that they haven't consistently thrown in ball games, except for the game against Houston when they got way ahead. They let him throw, and he was 14 of 19 in that one. Well, because otherwise, it's tough to get in a rhythm.
And I think that's true to some degree. Philip Fulmer said, hey, don't, T, we don't want you to lose the game. We can win it with other players.
Martin lofts it toward the back of the end zone. Incomplete, overthrown, looking for Sean Bryson. Champ Bailey had the coverage. That's why I thought it was a very good question that Mike Mayock asked Philip Fulmer there at halftime, when he said, will you, with the lead, bring it in a little bit and play more conservatively? Philip Fulmer said, no, we won't. But last week, he admitted that's clearly what they did do against Auburn. They got the lead. They didn't want to put T. Martin in a situation where he'd make the mistake that got the Tigers back in.
And I think the philosophy has changed, Sean, because of Jamal Lewis. When you don't have one of the best backs in the country on your sideline and in your huddle anymore, that affects your thinking. So you adjust, and it's good that the Tennessee coaches are as flexible as they are. They adjust with who they have to play with.
And also the fact that Georgia is a more explosive team than Auburn, they're more likely to score. To the end zone. Touchdown, Cedric Wilson.
Well, it's not very often you see Champ Bailey get beat, as good a defensive back as he is. But number 14, Cedric Wilson, goes in motion, and he's going to push up the field and then just snap it off. And T. Martin throws a beautiful ball. Only one guy is going to catch that ball, either Cedric Wilson or no one. Philip Fulmer knows That's a huge touchdown throw by T. Martin.
And they're going to go for two. For the first time this year, they'll attempt a two-point conversion with four wide receivers in the game. And they run the option. Martin down short of the goal line. They did not get the two. He hit down about the one and bounced to the goal line. Adrian Hollingshed made the tackle. So it's 15-3 with 12 and a half left in the third. First touchdown of the game, scored by Cedric Wilson on the pass from T. Martin. Tim Wansley has to down the kickoff from Hall. What a weapon Jeff Hall is with his field goals and with his kickoffs. Here's Mike Mayock.
Hey, Sean, in that last series for Tennessee, Jim Donnan walked all the way over to me and said, "Boy, Mike, I just can't believe how tight we're playing." And then he kind of paused and he said, "But this is where young kids grow up." You know, and down 15-3, we're in crunch time in the SEC, and I think it's going to be very interesting to watch how this young team reacts the rest of the way.
You know, sometimes, Mike, you can want to beat a team too badly. You know what I mean, Sean? You haven't beaten this team in 7 years. You want it so badly, you do play tight.
And right now, Tennessee and the Florida Gators are the teams to beat in this conference. They beat Florida last year, talking about Georgia. So this is the other hurdle to climb to really take your place among the elite in the Southeastern Conference. Rolandis Gary on the run, and Al Wilson made the stop for a loss. This is the Georgia record in the 90s against ranked teams, 6-23-1. They've only had one win at home against a ranked team in the 90s, and that was against Clemson in October of 1991.
Again, I'm not so sure that Georgia's playing tight, that Tennessee defensive front is controlling the game. They are whipping Georgia's offensive line up front.
Carter with time this time, has a receiver. It's the tight end, Jermaine Wiggins. Out across the 30 for a first down. They'll give him progress to the 31. Wiggins is a senior from East Boston, Massachusetts. The other transfer from Marshall, about whom we were speaking earlier. Jermaine has about 19 relatives and family members, friends from East Boston down here today. They've saved up, and this is the game they chose to come to. It was a long way from home. Most of the players on the Georgia team are Georgia natives. Wiggins caught 63 passes in 2 years at Marshall before coming over here to back up Larry Brown. Play action fake on first. Carter going deep, throws it too far, and it is intercepted. What a catch by Dwayne Goodrich. And he's tackled at the 41-yard line by Ronnie Bradley. The pass was intended for Thad Parker, but it looked like he stopped, and the ball was way overthrown, and Goodrich seemed to catch up to the ball as it hung in midair.
Well, there's no question Thad Parker, the receiver, did stop, and Dwayne Goodrich did not. He just kept competing for the ball. Dwayne Goodrich, a very talented cover man. You see the safety helping him out right there, number 33. He's right in the picture as well. Derek Edmonds, and sure enough, they bracket him, and he comes down with the great interception, Goodrich.
Seventh of his career. First this season for the junior from Oaklawn, Illinois. Tennessee with a chance to take command here in the third quarter. Travis Steven hounds it up the middle for two to the 43-yard line. Rich Robich, backup linebacker. Boy, and the tackle. Tennessee best in the conference in turnover margin.
Boy, that was great coverage, Sean. I go back to that play. You know, that safety bracketed that wide receiver, gave his cornerback help. It was tremendous defensive back play.
Georgia's had a problem with turnovers this season, now minus four for the year. And the biggest problem prior today have been fumbles. Up the middle, Stevens again. Hollingshed made the tackle. Stevens down at the 48-yard line. And it'll be third down and about three to go for the Volunteers with 10 minutes remaining in the third.
You know, you watch Tennessee play, and they're just a very solid team from stem to stern. I mean, you look at their kicking, you look at their offense, their defense. They've got speed on the field, athletes who make plays. They're a hard team to beat.
Third down, a short four. Good fake by Martin, and his pass is caught by Jermaine Copeland. First down Volunteers at the 33-yard line. That's a 20-yard gain. Larry Mann made the tackle. I've been impressed with T. Martin's ball faking ability today.
Yeah, it's certainly on that particular play. He made it look like a draw, and he held the Georgia defense. The inside, again, it's an inside route. Right inside, there's air in that defense. And so consequently, Tennessee is taking advantage of it. Jermaine Copeland in this particular case before Cedric Wilson. That's where he worked him.
First catch of the day for Copeland, the senior from Harriman, Tennessee. Back to the run, and Stevens running effectively. And the ball pulled out, but Stevens got it back. Jeff Harris made the tackle and ripped the ball out, but it fell right back into the lap of Travis Stevens. 13 yards on the rush for Stevens. He's up to 60 yards rushing on 12 carries.
Now the Tennessee offensive line surged off the ball. It's a little off-tackle play. And Travis Stevens really hit the seam there and hit the crack. Those tailbacks, they like to get that ball deep, get behind that big pulling guard and the fullback kicking out, and then scream for blood, and he hammers it.
From the 20-yard line of Georgia, Stevens trying to bounce it outside. Camp Bailey and Kirby Smart on the stop, but Stevens is running effectively. Now to the 12-yard line, that's a gain of 8.
Travis Stevens, the last two runs, Sean, has really gone downhill at the Georgia defense. He's taken the fight to them. He's attacking the line of scrimmage. The linemen are coming off, dominating the line of scrimmage, moving that defense out. Jim Donnan knows he's got a problem right now. Tennessee's starting to take over the game.
Second down and 2. Stevens down to the 5 with a first down. Arontis Grant and Kirby Smart made the stop. Philip Fulmer said the other night when we chatted with him that Stevens and Henry were both get an opportunity, but if one of them got hot, then they'd stay with the hot hand, and Stevens is a hot hand at the moment.
Right now, he's got the speed. He's the back with the breakaway speed. Travis Henry's a little more of a power back, but Travis Stevens is the breakaway guy, and you want big plays in your offense. Tennessee needs big plays.
They're moving toward the end zone in which most of their fans are sitting. Travis Henry in a tailback now on first and goal, just outside the 5. And they give it to the other Travis, and Henry gets stacked up right at the line of scrimmage. Richard Seymour and Dustin Lucky combined on the stop on Henry, who was Mr. Florida football in Frostproof, Florida, when he was a senior in high school. He set the national single season rushing record. Travis Henry rushed for 4,087 yards and 42 touchdowns in 14 games in his senior year in high school. He had one game he rushed for 436 yards. And in all 14 games, he had 200 yards or more.
And on defense, Johnny went over and played nose guard. Mm-hmm. How about that for a fast nose guard?
Second and goal. Sean Bryson, the lone back, with 4 wide receivers in the game. The option, Martin. Ducks underneath to the 3-yard line. Hollingshead made the stop for Georgia. Adrian's a sophomore from Fort Valley, Georgia. That was similar to the 2-point play that they ran moments ago.
You know, the Tennessee offensive line has done a very nice job today. Josh Tucker getting his first start of the year, number 77, the offensive tackle. Cozy Coleman, they took him from tackle, moved him over to guard. They've made some adjustments in there to try to get better matchups against the Georgia defense. And clearly in the second half here, those adjustments are starting to take effect.
Travis Rito, a big loss, the starting right tackle at the beginning of the year, out for the season with a fractured foot. Suffered in the game against Houston. On third and goal, they fake the inside handoff. They throw to Peerless Price, and he has a touchdown. T.
Tennessee just throws a quick screen out to the left. It's an easy play to execute. They're in the shotgun, so T. Martin's got plenty of room. He gets it out to Peerless Price, one of the top athletes in the Southeastern Conference. He goes man on man and beats the defender, puts the ball in the end zone.
Jeff Hall for the extra point. And the Tennessee lead is now 22-3. Peerless Price has now scored a touchdown in every game this season, with the exception of last week's ball game at Auburn.
NASDAQ College Football on CBS is sponsored by Suzuki, Fidelity Investments, Little Caesars, and by Enterprise.
Two touchdowns by Tennessee here in the third quarter. The last scored by Peerless Price, the senior from Dayton, Ohio. T. Martin threw the ball to Price, and the lead is 22-3. Jeff Hall kicks off again. This one is returnable. Tim Wansley, the true freshman from Buford, Georgia, bend it at the 12-yard line. Great coverage by Willie Miles, the freshman from Fort Worth, Texas.
John, Tennessee's done a great job kicking the ball away from Champ Bailey. They've not given Champ Bailey a chance to return any of these kickoffs, and as a result, Georgia has not enjoyed good field position the whole afternoon. Excellent special teams work by the Tennessee Volunteers.
Georgia begins at its own 13-yard line. A lot of work to do now, under 6 minutes remaining in the third quarter. And Georgia trails by 19. They run an option pitch to Gary. And he is buried after a quality game. He's close to a first down at the 23. Al Wilson and Raynock Thompson hit him hard along the sideline. Now back to the Aflac trivia question. And that was one of our Aflac trivia questions. We actually posed two today. Last two freshmen to start the season opener at quarterback for Georgia. I gave away that answer inadvertently at the top of the telecast. Johnny Roush went on to coach the Oakland Raiders after completing four brilliant years as quarterback here at Georgia. The other question that we asked was the last Georgia coach to beat Tennessee. And we'll reveal that answer in a moment. Gary stopped by Deion Grant. It was second down and inches, so Landis Gary did pick up the first down. Vince Dooley, the correct answer. Now the athletic director. Ray Goff did not have a win over in Tennessee during his time as the successor to Vince Dooley.
I had a nice visit with Vince Dooley yesterday. I stopped by the office to say hello to Vince and had a good visit. He's certainly proud of the Georgia football team and the way it's responded, and I know he was excited about today's game and obviously can't be real happy right now with the score, but Georgia's well on their way to regrouping their football program and getting it back to national prominence, regardless of the outcome of today's game.
Jim Donnan says it's so important this year. They don't want last season's 10-2 record to be viewed as a fluke. They don't want Georgia to be one of those teams that's thought of as kind of an up and down yo-yo team that every now and then throws in a good season. They want to consistently be at the top of college football, as they were under Coach Dooley for so many years. Carter's throw is incomplete along the near sideline. And there is a flag on the play. He was looking for Thad Parker right in front of the Georgia sideline.
John, I can't say enough about the Tennessee defense. They are in their eight-man front at times. They pressure the quarterback. They bring the outside linebackers, Raynock Thompson. They just have a lot of pressure going on Quincy Carter, and Carter looks like a totally different player. John Chavis down here at the end of the booth. John, and they had Quincy Carter looks like a different player to me today because of that pressure and because that defensive line of Tennessee is wearing them out up front. They're wearing them down.
Georgia had a lineman downfield. They turned down the penalty. It'll be second down and 10. Quincy Carter, a 21-year-old true freshman. Out of high school, he signed a letter of intent to go to Georgia Tech. And then he was drafted in the second round by the Chicago Cubs. He received a $425,000 signing bonus and elected to play professional baseball. And that's what he has done the last three summers. He pitches to Arnott. And Robert Arnott is close to another first down. Out across the 36-yard line. Deion Grant upended Arnott. Arnott bounced back and forth between offense and defense throughout his career. Played linebacker and safety at the end of last season. Moved back to running back this preseason.
Well-executed option play out of the shotgun by Quincy Carter. Came down the line of scrimmage. Optioned the defensive end. Pitched the ball off to Arnott. Positive gain for Georgia.
We're trying to get the running game going. Arnott had 90 of those yards you saw in the season opener route against Kent. A catch made by Tony Small. Steve Johnson gave him a pop after Small made the catch for a first down. And Georgia is starting to move the chains with some consistency for the first time today. That's a 13-yard gain.
Well, and Darwin Walker broke through the offensive line at Georgia, and did he deck Quincy Carter. Number 17, the quarterback, is going to get decked by 58 Darwin Walker. Welcome to being the starting quarterback in the SEC. That's a hit.
That might make him long for the baseball diamonds of Rockford, Illinois.
No, this guy's a quarterback. He's the real deal.
He has struggled to hit during his three minor league seasons at 248 this year, which was his best season with the bat. That could be grounding. No flag this time. Carter was in the grasp of Chris Ramsour, and he threw it away. And Philip Fulmer is irate. He has his hat off. He's out on the field and barking at the officials. And I think this time he has a beef.
No question about it. Philip has every right to be upset. There is no receiver in the area that he's trying to dump this ball to. This is a clear throwaway where the other one wasn't
yes.
a clear throwaway.
Well, maybe that's why they didn't get the call this time.
Well, I think they just missed the call. It happens. The game moves mm-hmm. fast. There's a lot of people moving around. But certainly Tennessee had a complaint on that particular play.
From midfield, second and 10. Tennessee leads by 19. Three-step drop and a catch made by Champ Bailey. Andre Lott, a reserve cornerback, had the coverage. First catch of the day for Champ Bailey.
Champ Bailey hasn't done a whole lot today like he did last week. But it's a little inside slant route. He just breaks it off inside. Fabulous hand-eye coordination. Once again, Quincy Carter takes a big hit by that Tennessee defensive line. What's happening is Tennessee is covering the three interior linemen, the center and the two guards, with down linemen, and then blitzing linebackers inside, and the Georgia offensive line can't quite pick it up.
They're just inches short of the first down. We mentioned last week, Champ Bailey last week had 7 catches against LSU for 114 yards and a touchdown. He also had 2 rushes for 15 yards. He played 95 plays in the game last week at LSU, 33 of them on offense. Third down and inches. And Carter keeps and picks up the first down across the 40.
Jim Donnan just trying to figure out, hey, boys, how can we get this chain, the chains moving? How can we get the ball going down the field? He loves offense. He serves as his own offensive coordinator, calls all the plays.
And how happy was he to get the surprise phone call from Quincy Carter to find out that Carter wanted to come back and play football in addition to his baseball exploits? Here comes the pressure, and it's fortunate for Georgia that the pass was incomplete. Al Wilson put the heat on Carter. And he took another hit, did Carter. And they were fortunate that Arnott had the ball sail by, because that was going to be stuffed too.
Well, number 27 on the inside blitz. He's a 4-5 kind of guy coming up the middle untouched. You can't let linebackers in a 4-3 defense. He plays right in the middle. You can find that guy. But they're getting the linemen covered, and consequently they're not being able to bump off and pick Al Wilson up. And he's putting tremendous pressure on Quincy Carter.
Second down and 10. 22-3 Tennessee. 3:16 remaining in the third. Out of the shotgun. Here comes the heat again. He throws on the run, and it is incomplete. Thrown into traffic. Carter can't even finish his drop. He barely gets away from center, and the heat is on. This Georgia offensive line is having a terrible time of it.
Well, you have to figure, too, when you haven't had your center all week long, you got Miles Lucky playing with a huge knee brace on his leg. He's just playing on heart, trying to get the ball back to center, but the Georgia line just can't get him blocked. The speed of the Tennessee defenders and the intensity of the blitz is what's disrupting the Georgia offense.
Eric Westmoreland came through completely untouched, and Derek Gibbons also made a big play, almost had the interception in front of Champ Bailey. Those numbers are sharp contrast to last week. His brilliant performance against LSU, but he's been fighting for his life today. Champ Bailey incomplete. He took a big pop from Dwayne Goodrich. Just when it looked like Carter's scramble was going to set up a big play, Bailey took a pop.
Well, it's a great play by Dwayne Goodrich. You got to give him credit. Champ Bailey had the ball in his hands. He just couldn't come down with it. Bailey runs across the field, number four. The quarterback scrambles, makes a great play. Bailey, tremendous leap by him. But what a hit by number 23, Dwayne Goodrich. And once again, Carter just running for his life, trying to keep from getting beat up out there.
Fourth and 10, it looks like Georgia is going to go for it. And they burned a timeout. Play clock is down to 10, and they were still in the huddle, confused. Back live in Sanford Stadium, Athens, Georgia. Big play upcoming here for the Georgia offense. Fourth and 10 of the Tennessee 40. They're down by 19 with time starting to wind down. Quincy Carter hasn't faced anything like this so far in his college career.
No question about it, Sean, but he's growing up as a quarterback today. He's shown tremendous toughness, and he hasn't been able to get his feet set a lot of times and perform like he did a week ago, but he's going to be a veteran. When this game is over, he will have earned his stripe, because Tennessee is bringing the heat, and they're going to bring it again.
They hand it off to Champ Bailey. He can throw it. They have it well covered, and it is intercepted. Deion Grant running it back. And he runs out of bounds at the 27-yard line. Well, Philip Fulmer and his Volunteers were not fooled by that play. Champ Bailey looking to throw it, and he threw into double coverage looking for Tony Small, and Deion Grant intercepted.
Well, give the Tennessee defense credit. They have taken everything that Georgia's had today and just turned it right on Georgia, and in this particular play, the ball just shouldn't have been thrown. It was double covered all the way. They're trying to get the ball to Champ Bailey on a little reverse pass. He comes out, but look at the coverage downfield. Downfield, double coverage on the wide receiver. No hope of getting the ball in there.
Martin rolls out and throws a rare completion to a tight end. And that's John Finlayson, just his second career catch.
Well, you talk about good coverage. Tennessee has him bracketed. Again, Deion Grant, the safety, coming over to help the corner. Tremendous safety play. Look at the coaches. Jim Donnan knows nothing's gone right today. Philip Fulmer knows he's got control of the game.
Second down and five after the catch by the redshirt freshman Finlayson from Selmer, Tennessee. Stevens has a first down out to the 39-yard line. Richard Seymour made the stop.
Sean, I know you have. I've been impressed with Travis Stevens.
Very much so.
He hammers him. He gets after it. He likes to attack it. He goes downhill. In coaching, you always say, find me a back that goes downhill at him, that attacks the defense. Travis Stevens, 25, he's getting it done today doing that. And again, there's some holes to run in because of that offensive line is punching him out. But still, he goes after it good.
He and Henry are certainly running backs who will be playing regularly at many other programs around the country, but at Tennessee, they're both stuck behind Jamal Lewis. Not for this season, but Lewis out of the year of the knee injury. Home run ball, incomplete. Good coverage by Glenn Ford on Peerless Price. And if anything, it was nearly offensive pass interference as Ford had the good position and Price bumped him a little bit from behind. Tomorrow, doubleheader NFL action here on CBS. The 1 o'clock games, Kansas City, New England, Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, Tennessee, and Baltimore, Buffalo, and Indianapolis. Then at 4:15, Denver and Seattle, the featured game with the Jets taking on St. Louis, San Diego, and Oakland. It all starts with the NFL Today, noon Eastern time, presented by Southwest Airlines. I know folks up in my part of the country are really looking forward to that Kansas City-New England game. Peerless Price drags the would-be tackler Jeff Harris close to a first down out of the 49-yard line. He might have picked up the first down with that rodeo routine.
Well, it was a nice checkoff by T. Martin. He audibles to this play. He just ran a little quick hitch. He gives the ball to an outstanding athlete, Peerless Price, strong, big physical receiver. Reminds you of the receivers Tennessee has historically had.
Guys like Alvin Harper and Carl Pickens, among others. And bringing on the chains. And Price did pick up the first down. And the Volunteers are winding down this third quarter clock, a minute 23 remaining. That's Todd Donnan on the right of your screen, the son of Coach Jim Donnan. Todd's a graduate assistant, works with the quarterbacks. He was a fine quarterback at Marshall, played for his dad back in the early 90s. Todd just finished his MBA work here at the University of Georgia. Travis Stevens. Down to the 28-yard line, and he all day long has refused to go down without a big fight.
But Travis Stevens has been waiting on the bench. He's wanted his opportunity, and he's playing, he was playing behind Jamal Lewis, and all of a sudden he gets his time to shine. And I've seen it so many times, year in and year out, guys who sit on the bench, all of a sudden they get their chance and they turn it on and take advantage. He's taking advantage of his opportunity today. He's been impressive.
To the tune of 104 yards rushing on 16 carries. First and 10, Tennessee, with under a minute remaining in the third quarter. They're the Georgia 28 after that pickup of 23. Travis Henry outruns Arontis Grant, and he's banged out of bounds, close to another first down. Let's get an update on the Florida State-Miami game from Tim Brando.
Sean, it's power football that's aiding Tennessee, and Bobby Bowden's going to turn to the same thing inside the five as the Seminoles begin to take control. William McCray goes in from 3 yards out. Peter Warwick, by the way, 7 catches, 190 yards, and a touchdown today.
The Seminoles seemingly on their way to victory there. And Tennessee in command of this one at the moment. With a half minute left in the third quarter. On the move again. Henry. Tackled by Rich Robich and Glenn Ford. How about Robich? When we talked to Joe Kynes yesterday, the defensive coordinator, he says Rich thinks it's 1953. It's a real throwback to the old days of football. Every day's Christmas. He's going 100 miles per hour in every place. It's sometimes not in the right direction, but you don't mind mistakes made when it's being made as a product of all-out effort.
Well, Joe Kynes, when he did visit with us yesterday, Sean, you know, you could just tell how much he enjoys coaching and being around the athletes, both he and Jim Donner.
He's not enjoying this experience. Stevens being tended to on the sideline at the end of the third quarter. The score, Tennessee 22, Georgia 3. We'll return to Sanford Stadium after this message and a word from your local station. Travis Stevens with a nice bag on his right arm. What a big day he's had. A career high 105 yards on 16 carries. And now a big play from the 20. Third down and short. They need to meet the 17-yard line. It looked like the ball came out as Travis Henry carried. And Tennessee got it back. And will it be enough for the first down? It's very close. There's an injured man on the field for Georgia. Josh Millard, the redshirt freshman nose guard. Well, they take a look at him. They might also bring out the chains for a measurement.
Travis Henry just tries to run an off tackle play in isolation. The ball came out before he ever got to the line of scrimmage. It was just a bad exchange between he and T. Martin. It wasn't really stripped. It just popped out.
And when you're having a day, as Tennessee is, those are the things that happen. You never get the handoff, and you still gain the 3 yards you need for the first down. Sean McDonald along with Terry Donahue. The big question coming into this game was the Tennessee running back situation. How would they be able to survive the loss of Jamal Lewis? They're surviving it very well.
Well, there's no question. The Tennessee offensive line has stepped up today. Travis Stevens, Travis Henry have both come through. And T. Martin has had a good day for Tennessee. You have to give him credit. He's one of those guys that, you know, you wonder how he's winning, but he's effective. He makes plays. He's a winning quarterback.
Josh Millard helped off. He's been called Mallard for much of his stint here at Georgia, but his dad says the family name is Millard. And he made quite an impact in his very first game. He had 3.5 sacks in their season opener against Kent. Has 6 for the season. Saw the numbers for the Stevens and Henry tandem, the two Travises. It's going to be Travi. Martin goes out of bounds, shoved out by Dustin Lucky. It seems like there are a number of Luckies in this game for Georgia. You're right. There are 3 Lucky brothers on this team, and they are triplets. The first triplets to sign with a major college program in the same year. Dustin, Miles, and Mike. And their mom, Wendy, who was a nurse, thanked them, said that earned them about $125,000 each, she figured, in scholarship money for the 3 all at one time. So she was happy all 3 sons earned the football scholarship at Georgia.
Those guys must have a ball, too. You know, 3 brothers playing together on the same team and talking about the struggles of football and celebrating a great win. That's got to be fun.
Terrific possession here by Tennessee. Time-consuming drive. Martin, they had him by the shirt, and they got him down. He was down at the 28-yard line. Hit it Richard Seymour and Dustin Lucky with that play, and it'll be a sack. It was behind the line of scrimmage. You mentioned the Lucky brothers, not only good football players, but all 3 graduated from high school in Stone Mountain, Georgia, with GPAs of 3.2 or better. And I imagine they can have some fun switching identities, fooling people. Maybe, I don't want to cause any problems, but they are a 3-dog family. I thought that was a great heading for them.
No question. I tell you, and all good football players.
Yes. 2 of them starters, Miles and Dustin. Mike is a backup linebacker. Tennessee in reverse at the moment. 3rd down, 22. Jermaine Copeland, the move man. Travis Henry stopped at the 21. Flag down in the backfield. It was Dustin Lucky again on the tackle.
We've got motion against Tennessee. They jumped just a little bit early. Sean, they're going to back him up 5 more yards.
I would think that they would. They could turn it down and make it 4th down, but this is field goal range for Jeff Hall. And another field goal makes it a 22-point game. Well, that's a tough number to overcome. 19 is tough enough, but
illegal shift on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat 3rd down.
We're back at the 34. Still in field goal range for Hall, but there would be a very long drive from here of about 51 yards. Hey. Like a 5. Agitated on that sideline.
Look at Uga. Uga doesn't like the way this thing has gone down today.
Well, if they put Uga in the game, they might do a little better rushing the football. They handed it to Uga. Martin on 3rd down, stripped of the football, and again Tennessee gets it back. Marcus Stroud ripped it out, but Posey Coleman was the man in the right place for the Volunteers.
Well, Marcus Stroud comes on an outside rush and just keeps pressuring the quarterback. He comes from the left and he never stops. He goes ahead and beats Josh Tucker 77 and strips the ball. But it seems like it's Tennessee's day today. They fumble the ball and recover. They fumble the ball and they recover.
And Coach Fulmer will punt with the loss on that play back to the 36-yard line. David Leverton will try to pin George in deep.
This is a good decision. Your defense is playing well. Run the clock down here. Take a penalty.
Even though Tennessee didn't score any points on this possession, Coach, they took a lot of time off the clock. An effective possession nonetheless.
Tennessee plays to their strength as good as anybody that I've seen this year. They never try to overplay a game. You know, if they don't feel good about the throwing game, they say, hey, we're going to run it, and that's the way it's going to be. And then certain days they play a little looser than others, depending on who they're playing against. Phillip Fulmer and his staff, they do a marvelous job. You got to give them credit. I think they really did a good job with the game today, handling all the pressure. And a lot of people thought they were going to get beat today. And David Cutcliffe did a good job with the offense. It's not over, I know, but Chavis on defense, they've done an excellent, excellent game management job.
Well, Champ Bailey is back for the punt. And you talk about Tennessee getting bounces all day, and how about that bounce? He actually dove into the end zone with the ball. We'll see if they spot that down at the 1 yard line. Andre Lott downfield to down it. Well, that punt hit it about the one, and now they do call it a touchback. They got a great bounce on the punt, but Lott took the ball over the plane of the goal line. This one, it looked like Tennessee would capitalize on another good bounce. It goes the other way. Oh, 22-3, Tennessee. Hopefully they'll be home in time tonight for the lineup on CBS. You can spend a day at the races with tomorrow's sports section. It's a sure bet on Early Edition. Then Samo infiltrates a gang of high-tech crooks on martial law. That word was infiltrates. And Chuck Norris stars in Walker, Texas Ranger. America's Night of Heroes tonight on CBS. Pass caught by Champ Bailey, but for no gain. He went to the ground to catch the aerial from Quincy Carter. And Carter has been under siege all day.
Well, there's no question that Tennessee defensive line and linebackers have just really put the pressure on this freshman quarterback.
Now, if you were Jim Donnan, would you be inclined to tell your offense, hey, we need to get in and out of the huddle here a little more urgently?
I think Jim will probably start speeding it up here.
Carter throws again for Champ Bailey, this time a first down. Tackled by Dwayne Goodrich. That's out to the 31, a gain of 11.
Yeah.
There are the numbers today for Champ Bailey. And there's his mother, Elaine. Another of the three Baileys who have played here at Georgia. Ronald graduated after last year, went to camp with the Cowboys, had a hamstring injury, and was let go by Dallas. Champ's here. Many think he might leave at the end of this his junior season and head for professional football. And Boss is a true freshman. There's an injured volunteer on the play. That was the man who made the tackle, Dwayne Goodrich. We were talking about Quincy Carter and how he came to Georgia. We mentioned he signed with Georgia Tech out of high school, but then went to play professional baseball. And he takes the shotgun snap. That has Tony Small, and Small has a seam. In the Tennessee territory at the 45-yard line. Derek Edmonds made the tackle, a 23-yard gain for the senior from Jacksonville, who was a wing T quarterback in high school.
Georgia did a nice job. They spread the field, got their quarterback Quincy Carter in the shotgun, and just ran an underneath little slip screen to Small. He was wide open inside and just took it right up the middle of the defense.
At the 45-yard line. Six catches today for 125 for Small. Here comes Carter on the run. Quincy Carter out of bounds at the 34-yard line. Quincy Carter told us when we chatted with him yesterday, I always wanted to go to Georgia, but coming out of high school, when it's time to make the decision, it was right at the time of the coaching change, and I didn't know Jim Donnan. I didn't know what the program would be like. So I decided to sign with Georgia Tech. Then baseball came, so I went there. But when I knew I wanted to come back to football, I was more interested in Georgia because I always wanted to go there, and because Mike Bobo was graduating. He had been the starting quarterback, and Georgia Tech had Joe Hamilton coming back.
Yeah, he saw an opportunity to play faster at Georgia than at Georgia Tech, and that's usually why guys decide to go to school.
Carter throws. Champ Bailey's open, and the pass is incomplete. It was belted out of bounds by Deion Grant. And Jim Donnan said, that in his recruiting class year, Quincy Carter, in his opinion, was right there with Tim Couch as the two best quarterbacks. And Quincy made the decision to come back. He could not participate in this year's spring practice a couple of months ago here at Georgia because he did have that commitment to Georgia Tech. That commitment had to expire of 2 years, but he did watch spring practice.
Well, Jim said he did a great job melting in with the rest of the players. He moved into the dorm. He really just kind of got accepted by everybody. You know, he's a pro athlete. He could have lived off campus, I'm sure, in a condominium, an apartment, but he went into the dorm and got with his teammates, and that's important.
Finds a seam over the middle again. Small has a first down inside the Tennessee 15. Tony was tackled by Deion Grant. 20 yards on the completion. Quincy Carter to Tony Small.
And Tony Small lines up in the slot. He's the inside receiver. He's going to run down the field, come to the inside. There's a wide open seam in the Tennessee defense. And Quincy Carter, for one of the only times today, had time to get his feet set, planted, and rip the ball down the field.
By far the most impressive drive for Georgia. And just as we say that, it looked like Matt Stinchcomb, the tackle, came out of his stance. Whistles were blowing, but the players didn't hear them, and Carter was dumped, and the crowd wanted a flag on Tennessee. It looked like Quincy was saying to the referee, Steve Shaw, "Hey, I've taken enough hits today without that one," after the whistle.
Well, Matt Stinchcomb, 79, he's the one that jumps early, and you don't expect that from a senior like Matt. He just got a little anxious to get out there on the pass protection. Looked like they were going to throw a little screen again, another little slip screen inside.
Stinchcomb is our NASDAQ Scholar Athlete of the Game. NASDAQ's commitment to the future of our country is demonstrated today by the donation of $1,000 to Georgia's General Scholarship Fund. Matt, in addition to being a great football player, is going to be a first-round pick in the next draft, is a 3.94 GPA. Carter over the middle, too long. Looking for Jermaine Wiggins, the tight end who was running free, but the pass was deep, and it'll be second down and 15 from the 20-yard line.
Georgia has no backs in the backfield. They just have Quincy Carter back there. They're trying to spread the Tennessee defense. Tennessee comes with the blitz anyway. They have an unblocked man from the outside, and all Carter needs to do is just put a little more air under that ball, and he'll learn how to do that. He'll eventually, that next time he throws that pass, he'll hit it.
9:55 remaining. That last Tennessee possession that didn't result in points did consume 5 minutes and 37 seconds over 12 plays. Carter forced to pitch it. Good one-handed catch by Arnott. He cuts it back inside. And he gets hammered at the 12 by Raynock Thompson.
Almost looked like, Sean, if he kept the ball outside, there was more yardage there. Quincy Carter runs the option to perfection. He comes right down the line of scrimmage, attacks the end, and he deals the ball off very nicely before he takes a hit, pitches it, and right there, the cutback, he actually, I thought, should have kept the ball outside. There was a lot more room out there. You can see the velocity of that hit that the quarterback has to take and that Arnott takes.
Timeout, Georgia. They're burning timeouts. Just one remaining now for the Bulldogs. Third down for Georgia at the 13 of Tennessee. The Dogs desperately in need of a touchdown with 9.5 minutes remaining. Carter has time, throws much too high, across the middle looking for Small. And a field goal doesn't really do much good. It gets you within 16, two touchdowns and 2-point conversions, but you would think they'd have a better chance of any kind of a comeback if they get a touchdown.
Yeah, I think they're in four down territory here. And although I think that Jim's going to go for this and try to somehow get a touchdown or a first down. He can still get a first down inside the 5-yard line. Champ Bailey wanting the ball again, but he's covered. Dwayne Goodrich all over in number 23. He just hasn't.
Virtual must convert situation here for Georgia on 4th down and 7. Carter has time. A soft rush this time. He lofts it toward Champ Bailey. Incomplete. Bailey was open that time, but it was an errant throw as Carter drifted to his left.
Champ Bailey trying to work to get open in the end zone. Quincy Carter flushed a little bit early from the pocket, and understandably so with all the pressure that he's had today. But Champ Bailey doing a good job of separating from the defensive back. He's open in the corner. Right here, Carter flushes out and actually runs into Corey Terry, number 22, and that makes the throw more difficult.
Quincy Carter today, 14 out of 34. Eight touchdowns, eight quarters rather, without allowing a touchdown for this impressive Tennessee defense. Travis Stevens was tackled by Adrian Hollingshead. They made a conscious decision, it seemed, the Tennessee coaches on defense, going for speed over size, particularly the linebacker position. And that speed has been in evidence all day today against the Georgia offense.
No question about it. They took a page probably out of Florida, Florida State. Teams at Nebraska, teams that have really gone to speed. Tennessee went to speed. Those three inside linebackers, there's not one of them 220. You know, they're 210, 215 pounds, but they can motor and they can run you down.
Travis Stevens bounces it outside. He's pulled down by Arontis Grant. Down on the sidelines, Mike Mayock.
Sean, sometimes you get a different perspective on the field, but I couldn't agree with you more about the Tennessee defense. It's the fastest front seven I think I've seen this side of Florida, and I think they've done a great job of stressing the center position on either side of the ball. You know, the other obvious thing with Tennessee's offense, Mike Barry, their offensive line coach, told me before the game, he thought they could wear their defense down by the third quarter, and that's exactly what happened. Tennessee had 56 rushing yards in the first half, and then 116 in the third quarter. So I think it's team speed on defense and that big offensive line taking over in the second half.
Well, I agree, Mike, 100%. I think they've worn them down. And Georgia plays 12 defensive linemen.
And third and eight, Martin keeps and picks up another first down.
Well, that was a big play right there, Sean. You know, Georgia holds them there. They get the ball back, maybe get into two-minute offense, get a chance to get back on the board, and who knows what's going to happen. But that was a big scramble by T. Martin. And Tennessee has done what they wanted to do. They have had balance in their offense. They've been able to run it, and they've thrown it pretty effectively.
Well, it's hard to get a read on this Tennessee team. We mentioned they were an underdog coming into today's game. The trendy pick seemed to be Georgia. They were the team coming in off an impressive win, albeit by a point at LSU. It was on the road in a hostile place that really earned them some believers. But Tennessee has the win over Syracuse at the Carrier Dome. They have the win against Florida, out of conference against Houston, the struggle against Auburn, the victory here today. And yet you don't get the sense that people fully believe that this is a top five football team. I think they're earning some believers today.
Yeah, probably because they're not very impressive offensively. Mm-hmm. You know, they're a defensive team and a great kicking team.
Yes.
And you know, a lot of people, that doesn't catch their fancy. Mm-hmm. You know, but because they're not going to put up a whole lot of points. Not yet till T. Martin develops. Remember, he's a first-year quarterback, even though he's not a freshman. He's still not really experienced, so he's growing.
6.5 minutes left. Stevens gang tackle. The ball came out after the whistle. Brandon Miller put the primary pop on Travis Stevens. Let's find out how the Orangemen are doing today from Tim Brando.
Speaking of Syracuse, as Sean McDonough was, how about this Jekyll and Hyde team? Off the play fake with a reverse, Donovan McNabb goes 56 yards to Maurice Jackson against winless Cincinnati next Saturday. Many will see Syracuse and Boston College on CBS. Now let's go back to a proud alum.
That's right. My beloved Orangemen, Cincinnati, team that was in a bowl game last year. Admittedly, they bought their way into a bowl game in Boise by promising a few basketball games, but they still were a bowl team last year, and they've gone from a great year to just an awful year. Martin keeps the round end. He didn't want to go out of bounds, but he did to stop the clock at the 35-yard line, 5:34 remaining. Kirby Smart chased him out. Next Saturday, points leader Dale Earnhardt Jr., Matt Kenseth, Randy LaJoy, and Adam Petty are among those expected to slug it out at the CarQuest Auto Parts 250. That's next Saturday at 12:30 Eastern Time. That's interesting wording, slug it out. Let's hope they don't. Let's hope they all drive safely in their own space. Sometimes they slug it out outside the vehicles. They get a little angry about something that happened on the track, and the next thing you know, there's some fisticuffs. Chris, we have that in Boston, too.
On a regular basis.
On the highways and byways. Champ Bailey running back the punt from David Leverton. He has room along the far sideline. And Leverton helped push Bailey out of bounds. 51 yards on the kick and 19 on the return. 5:18 remaining. Georgia back on offense at its own 34-yard line, down by 19. When we return to Athens, Georgia, with more NASDAQ college football. Now, you gentlemen, back here, Georgia came in on a roll dating back to last year. 15 out of 17 in the win column for Coach Donnan. Well, they're down by 19 as they get it back. Quincy Carter throws it up for grabs. They're trying to set up a screen to Orlandis Gary. And once again, Carter hit the deck, this time in the arms of Jeff Coleman. Time now for our CBS Sportsline stat of the game. Complete college football coverage. Go to cbs.sportsline.com. Tennessee, who needs Jamal Lewis? 183 yards of rushing today.
Well, you got to be impressed with that offensive line over there with Mike Berry right there. They're talking about what they got done, and they got it done today. And certainly Travis Stevens, he came to the front, and all of a sudden now they found another tailback. But this defense on the field, this defense has put relentless pressure on the Georgia offense.
And on the receiver, Tony Small, as they try to set up another screen, and Eric Westmoreland batted it down. Here's Tim.
Sean, Bobby Newcomb trying to bring Nebraska back. They trailed by as much as 28-7. But watch this pass. Cedric Curry will intercept it to seal the deal. Nebraska's 19-game win streak is snapped. You'll recall that loss to Texas in the Big 12 title game. Dante Hall and Jamar Toombs, each over 100 yards rushing. A shocker that certainly changes the landscape of college football.
Indeed it does. Not that shocking to you. You were the only one I heard today say that's going to be a very tough ball game for Nebraska.
Yeah, I think Nebraska went into that game hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And when both your quarterbacks are banged up, you can't play the same kind of way. You know, hey, there's so much football left. Everybody wants to choose the Fiesta Bowl participants now, you know.
Right.
But there are so many big games and weeks ahead of us. I mean, who knows what's going to happen? UCLA tonight against Arizona. Be a tough match. Kansas State at Colorado. Everybody says Kansas State's not for real. They've played a soft schedule. I think they're for real. I think they're big time.
Well, Tennessee's going to move up to at least number three. Well, who knows if UCLA loses, they could move up to number two. They probably would. And as you said earlier, the schedule seems to get a little easier for Tennessee beyond here. They've had some very tough games already with Florida and Syracuse and Auburn and Georgia. To say it's a mass exodus from Sanford Stadium would be an understatement, as that picture tells you. Here's what they've done so far. They have next week off, and then Alabama at home, a game many of you will see here on CBS. They're at South Carolina. That should be an easy win. They go out of conference for Alabama-Birmingham. Arkansas much improved, but that's a home game. Kentucky is a home game, then at Vanderbilt. They're going to be favored considerably in every one of those
games. Every one of those games to run the table. But hey, you know, whoever wins Kansas State, Colorado, and UCLA, Arizona tonight, those teams have good chances too, you know. So there's a lot left. I've just been in it long enough to know enough games and enough years that, hey, who knows what's going to happen.
Tonight on CBS, it's Martial Law. If you haven't seen this program, you really must see it to believe it. Sammo Hung is a superstar of the martial arts. He's kicking the fun back into Saturday nights, and we're still looking for our guest shot because the NFL guys had their guest shot. So we're looking for Sammo to invite us on a martial arts.
I think, Sammo will do it. I really do. I think he's a college football fan. He loves college football.
I'll tell you what, he find a way to get a couple of tough yards in traffic. Martin off the fake, throws to Bryson. And he's out across midfield. Well, it'll be interesting to watch the last few minutes of this game, Coach, because we had the controversy last year. Did Tennessee run up the score late in the game in Knoxville? It's a little too early to say they're running it up now, but they are still throwing and advancing the ball down the field with Georgia seemingly easily defeated. And they have just one timeout left. We think back to last year when Jim Donnan at the end of the ball game was screaming at Fulmer. You heard him say, with Retta's lips there to see him say, "Hey, Fulmer." And they had a very quick handshake, but Jim Donnan told them during that handshake that he did not appreciate what he felt was an attempt to run up the score. Phil Fulmer's response was that Georgia was still blitzing, so we're going to keep throwing. Some said it was an attempt to build Peyton Manning's Heisman Trophy stats.
You know, I just think things happen in football games. You know, I think the emotions run so high, and I'm sure that after the game, 2 weeks after that, neither one of them think about it. Now, and then you get ready for this game, and it comes back to the front, and of course, people talk about it and all that kind of thing. But once the game starts, I promise you, all that goes out the window. You're just trying, Jim Donnan, he's just trying to move the ball and figure out what happened to my offense. And Phillips Fulmer, he's trying to stop him and win the game. So
I think Georgia has to find a way to get the running game going. I mean, if they're really going to be a top 10, top 15 team this year, well, they need to find some way to run the football.
Now, they're not real balanced right now, and they need to take some pressure off their freshman quarterback.
Travis Henry bowls his way to another first down. So the picture a lot brighter after this ball game for Tennessee in the SEC standings and in the bowl championship series picture. Here's Mike Mayock.
You guys have been talking about that very picture. You know, it gets very interesting, Sean. You talked about them maybe moving up probably to number three. UCLA has Arizona tonight. Nebraska's lost, but let's think about Kansas State right now. Kansas State not only has to play Colorado, but also Nebraska. So indeed, Tennessee will move up one, if not two spots. And let's face it, Sean and Terry, even though it's way too early in the season to start talking about January 4th, Tennessee certainly at this point has control of their own destiny.
A favorable schedule.
And you have to wonder how much the game against Nebraska last year, where Tennessee was soundly defeated in the Orange Bowl, helped them prepare for this season and a run at the national championship. You know, they were in a championship game last year at the Orange Bowl. Nebraska wins the national championship, at least a share of it in that game. Tennessee wouldn't have had a shot at it, but still they were in a big game like that, and that carries a momentum into the next year.
On second down, Travis Henry gets close to the first down. We're down to a minute and a half left.
It's a big win for Tennessee, as you said, Sean. Their schedule is very advantageous the rest of the way, and they were physical in this game and came in as kind of an underdog, which you mentioned. You know, a lot of people thought, myself included, that, hey, if Quincy Carter can play like he did against LSU, they can beat this team, you know, but he didn't. He didn't have the time. And the Tennessee defense just put it to them today.
College Football Today postgame show is next. Of course, tomorrow it's the NFL Today, beginning at noon Eastern time. And we want to send along our best wishes to our technical director, Jeff Ringel, who's worked with us for many years on college football. He's moving to join the big boys in the NFL Today studio next week. And he'll be leaving our crew. Phillip Fulmer with the congratulatory kiss. And we wish Jeff Ringel well. We're going to miss him out here in college football, but we're happy for him as he gets a terrific assignment.
No question. Good for him.
He's a terrific guy and a very, very talented television person. Well, the pictures on each sideline let you know without any question who won this ball game, and really a crushing defeat for Georgia in the standpoint. They were very confident. I think they felt this was the year they would end this losing streak against Tennessee. Instead, it's eight straight losses for Georgia against Tennessee, most ever against an opponent in the conference for the University of Georgia. And Tennessee goes to 5-0 with some of the toughest games on their schedule already out of the way. Perhaps the toughest games out of the way. Here's Mike with the winning coach.
Coach, this is getting to be a habit.
I'm enjoying every minute of it. We need to keep doing it.
Halftime, we talked. You're up 9-3. You said you weren't going to pull the horns in. But I got to tell you what, forget the offense for a minute. Tell me about your defense.
Our defense has played incredible all year. They're a pressure defense. They'll go after you. We put our corners out there on islands, and they make plays, and a rush can get to people. And it's been a special year that way. This group of kids just particular, you know, we lost so many people to graduation, and they've just had so much to prove all year long. It's been incredible.
Well, with Jamal being down, it sure looked like your offensive line, as the game went on, started to take it over. Boy, those guys are battle tested.
They are a good group. We've got one of our best ones out, Jarvis Rito, who we hope to get back real soon. And I can, you know, being an O-line coach myself, I can't help but be proud of them. You have to say an awful lot of good things about Travis Stevens and Travis Henry. Both of them stepped up big at tailback with the loss of our great tailback.
Last question, T. Martin, give me an overview.
I think T's growing all the time. I mean, he's stuck it in there a few times like you're supposed to. He'll keep learning, keep getting better. The greatest thing about T. Martin's his heart. His heart's in the right place, and he wants to do well, and he's got ability, and he's going to be a very, very fine college player, and he's a winner in 5-0.
Coach, his heart's 5-0. Sean?
Well, Philip Fulmer said he told his team after they found out Jamal Lewis would not play this week that everybody had to raise the level of their play, and that's what happened today. The offensive line that he mentioned, the defense, the running backs, the quarterback, receivers, all contributed to this impressive win. Once again, the final score of today's game, Tennessee 22 and Georgia 3. Now for Mike Mayock and Terry Donahue, I'm Sean McDonough saying so long from Sanford Stadium in Athens, Georgia. We'll rejoin the College Football Today postgame show right after this.